Johnson has commented about how much he admires your poise and composure. Do you feel like that's something that's one of your strengths?
I do feel like that's one of my strengths. I feel like that I have the mentality that when I go out on the mound that nobody else is going to beat me. And I think that mentality is how it's supposed to be, and that's what I stick by.
So, like I said, big series win over Florida. You know, a lot has been made of the fact that after the game won on Friday night, there seemed to be a new energy in the dugout on Saturday and Sunday. Tell us about that and where that came from and how it helped you guys, especially you when you were pitching on Sunday.
Right. Well, after Friday's loss, Coach Johnson, you know, just talked to us and just told us to attack the game and don't let the game attack you before you start attacking. So that was our whole mentality, is to attack the game before it attacks us. And that's what we did. And we got the energy in the dugout, and I think everybody was really engaged. And, you know, we need to keep that same energy going forward. If we do, we get.
Absolutely. And, of course, this is a big game tonight. I know Coach Johnson has said, he told you guys at the start of the season, this is a 56-game playoff. So every game is big. So ULM tonight. Devin Fontenot on the mound. One end of the spectrum, you as a true freshman, Devin, a fifth-year senior. Just talk about Devin and what he means to the staff.
Devin, obviously, is a veteran. He's had a lot of good outings earlier this year and over his last 4 years that he's been here. And, you know, he brings a lot of experience to our pitching staff, and it'll be very good to see him start.
Great. Well, look, Samuel, appreciate it. Good luck the rest of the year. Great job so far. We'll see you this weekend against Auburn.
Sir, thank you.
All right, Samuel, with us on Talking with Tigers. A lot more to come after this on the LSU Sports Radio Network.
Dad, how do airplanes fly?
Another beautiful day here at Alec Box Stadium. We get ready for midweek action. Louisiana Monroe coming down to take on your Fighting Tigers of LSU. Fans, Tabasco sauce, they've been exciting taste buds for over 150 years. Remember, bring the heat to your next game day with Tabasco sauce, the number one pick of the LSU Tigers. Big weekend coming off the weekend for LSU, taking 2 of 3 against the Florida Gators for the first time, a series win in Gainesville for LSU since 2012. And in fact, the first home loss in a series for the Gators in their new ballpark. And you got to go back to 2019, the last time they lost an SEC series. But let's update you on what's going around the SEC here on this Tuesday, headed into the third week of conference play. And with that, once again, to my left, happy to present former Tiger champ Doug Thompson. Doug.
Thank you, brother. We will start off looking at the standings, as always, in the East. Tennessee leads the way with the best record in the SEC. They are 6-0, Vanderbilt's 4-2, Georgia and Florida are 3-3. Kentucky is 2-4, along with South Carolina, and Missouri is 1-5 in the basement of the East. Now looking at the West, Arkansas leads the way. They're 5-1. There are four teams, folks, at 3-3. That's Auburn, LSU, Texas A&M, and Mississippi State. Ole Miss and Alabama are at the bottom at 2-4. There is all kinds of action tonight around the league. 13 games in total. The furthest along right now, they're in the bottom of the fourth inning. Georgia hosting Georgia Southern tonight in Athens. The Bulldogs lead it 2-1. Kentucky and Eastern Kentucky are tied at one apiece in the bottom of the second inning out in Lexington. In Columbia, Missouri and Illinois have no score. They're in the top of the first inning. In the bottom of the first inning, the Mississippi State Bulldogs on the road tonight in Memphis. There's no score yet there in the bottom of the first. Vanderbilt and Lipscomb just underway in Nashville. South Carolina's given up an early lead in the top of the first inning to Presbyterian in Columbus. Auburn also has surrendered a run in the first inning to Jacksonville State. Jacksonville State leads that game 1-0 in the bottom of the first. Also in the bottom of the first, Alabama hosting South Alabama. No score in that game. Florida and Florida State, big matchup there. They're in the top of the first inning, and there's no score, although the Seminoles have two hits in the top of the first. Later tonight at 6:30, due to start, Texas is hosting Texas A&M in Austin. Ole Miss will be in Oxford against North Alabama, and Chris, Arkansas will be in Fayetteville against Little Rock.
All right, thank you, Doug. Fans, J&J Exterminating. Remember, your best defense against pests, get the shield. Both teams loosening up. Both teams just about set to go with first pitch coming just after 6:30 here on this Tuesday evening. We'll continue with more on the Cajun Country Rice On Deck show. And we come back, we'll take a look at the starting pitchers for both the Warhawks and the Tigers. Stay with us here on the LSU Sports Radio Network. Back with you here on the Cajun Country Rice On Deck show. Remember, fans, this season, Cajun Country Rice giving Tiger fans the chance to honor their favorite home chef and crown them as the all-star MVP. Everybody's got that one person, so put the spotlight on your favorite culinary connoisseur. Each month, the winner will be announced during LSU baseball game broadcast, and they'll receive the title of all-star MVP along with a prize basket from Cajun Country Rice. Just visit CajunCountryRice.com/LSU Tigers and submit the name of your favorite amateur chef, and they could be a winner. Let's take a look at the starting pitchers for tonight's game between UL Monroe and LSU. Familiar name, maybe not a familiar starter, but Doug Thompson, the Tigers, going to try something a little different here for this midweek. Again, bookended with a trip to Gainesville, Tuesday night game, one day off, and then a SEC series beginning on Thursday. We can expect to see a number of arms, but let's take a look at the two starters for tonight's game.
Yeah, a couple of right-handers. We'll start off with Michael Howell. He will be the starter tonight for UL Monroe. Howell's a big guy. Stands in there at 6'7", 225 pounds. He's a junior with 4 years in college. He comes out of Northeast Texas Community College. not a lot of action this year, his junior year. He comes in with a 2.08 ERA. Only three appearances. This is his first start of the year. Four and a third innings. He's allowed two hits, two runs, only one earned. He has four walks and eight strikeouts. Opponents hitting 133. And for the Tigers, it'll be Devin Fontanasty getting a start. His first start of the season. Fontenot comes into the game with a 1.98 ERA. He's 1-1 in nine appearances. He's worked 13 and two-thirds innings, allowed 12 hits and six runs. Three of those have been earned, five walks and 15 strikeouts for Fontenot. Perhaps an audition for a weekend spot? Maybe. I do know that Jay Johnson is very interested to see Devin Fontenot, Chris, come out of the bullpen to start off a game instead of in the middle of the game and with a fire burning.
Absolutely. It'll be the first start since 2019 for Devin Fontenot. It'll be his sixth career start for the LSU Fighting Tigers. Fans, always hit a home run on your projects with equipment powered by Sunshine, your hometown John Deere dealer in Louisiana. We keep leading you up to first pitch tonight, ULM and LSU here at the box. Stay with us. Had a chance to visit with head coach Jay Johnson. His thoughts on this past weekend and the upcoming week for the Fighting Tigers. It's coming your way next here on the LSU Sports Radio Network.
There's a strike from Tyler Matthew. Great job.
Test one. 1-2. 1-2-3. 1-2. Back here getting ready for midweek action. LSU hosting ULM at the box. Time now to take a look at the Cintas starting lineup. First for UL Monroe, 8-13-1. Their record on the season, 3-2-1 in Sun Belt Conference play. Mason Holt will lead it off, being center field. A senior for the Warhawks batting 312. Ryan Cupid in left field, a senior hitting 321. Will bat second. Grant Schultz at third base will bat third. Another senior to start this lineup off for Coach Federico. 319 the average for Schultz this season. Landon Cato will be the DH. He'll be the cleanup hitter. Sophomore with a 304 average. Michelle Artzenberger, first baseman, will bat fifth. 213 the average on the season. Colby DeVille, the shortstop, will bat sixth. Second baseman Travis Washburn will be in the seventh spot. Trace Henry, the right fielder, will bat eighth. And Matthew Lee will be behind the plate catching. He will round out the lineup for the Warhawks. Again, Michael Howe will be on the mound, a junior right-hander with a 2.08 ERA, making his fourth appearance, first start of the season. Team so far have batted 133 against Howe. Now for your Fighting Tigers of LSU, 17-7 their overall mark, 3-3 in SEC play. Gay Doty will be atop the order. We saw that this past weekend. Coach Jay Johnson sticking with that, the shortstop. Sophomore batting 366. Trey Morgan will be in the two spot. He'll be at first base hitting 330. Dylan Cruz will bat third, the center fielder, with a 364 average. Jacob Berry will remain in the cleanup spot. He'll be at third base hitting 343. Jordan Thompson, second baseman, will bat fifth for the Tigers, just over 300 at 301. Braden Joubert coming off a sensational weekend. 3 home runs, 9 RBIs, 5 runs scored. Joubert, the sophomore, hitting 312, will be in the sixth spot. Gavin Dugas in left field hit a couple of dingers on the weekend. He'll bat seventh. Giovanni DiGiacomo in right field will bat eighth. And Hayden Travinsky, back-to-back starts, catching for the Tigers. He also had 2 round trippers in the series against the Florida Gators, the sophomore batting 214. Devin Fontenot will make his 6th start of his career, first of the season. The senior right-hander, a 1.98 ERA, 1-1 on the year. This will be his 10th appearance. Again, his first start. Team's batting 240 against Devin Fontenot. That is the Cintas starting lineup. We wrap up the Cajun Country Rice On Deck show up next. First pitch, ULM and LSU coming your way on the LSU Sports Radio Network. Good Tuesday evening, Tiger fans. Welcome in to Skip Bertman Field inside Alec Box Stadium, along with our producer Hunter McCann back in the Capital One studios. Former Tiger champ Doug Thompson, Chris Blair with you. Happy to have you with us as we get ready for another in-state battle in college baseball. The Warhawks of ULM travel down from Funroe, Louisiana to take on your Fighting Tigers. Again, the Warhawks 8-13-1. Could not finish or wrap up the final game of a three-game set against Coastal Carolina in the opening weekend of Sun Belt play due to a time limit. That game left tied 17-17.
What?
So they have one tie on their overall record, and they are 3-2-1 in Sun Belt play. The Tigers, again, coming off a phenomenal weekend on the road, taking 2 of 3 from a top-10 Florida Gator squad in Gainesville. Now 17-7, their overall mark. And they are back to 500, 3-3 in SEC play. They'll play tonight, off tomorrow, and get ready for Auburn Thursday, Friday, and Saturday right back here at Alec Box Stadium. And, Doug, I mentioned from the outset that the Tigers didn't need fuel. They had momentum to fly back from Florida. It was a very passionate group of Tigers, maybe the most passionate and energetic I have seen in several years. Coach Jay Johnson talked about it. Fans who watched and listened talked about the difference in the team, and you know, you get the sense when you go inside the dugout in the clubhouse that that's kind of what this coaching staff's hoping for, and we'll see if it carries over into tonight's game and into the weekend.
Well, some call it passion, some call it pride, and you know, I played on some teams with a lot of pride every time we went on the field, regardless of the opponent, and pride in the people that came before us, right? And this is one of the best college facilities in all of the land, and one of the best programs in the country, with the best fans, I might add. And I saw it too, Chris. I saw some energy, I saw some passion, and there's some pride with what they're wearing on their chest. Maybe some signs of life here for the Tigers, who, wow. I mean, you go from really not being able to do much with the ball offensively to the last 2 days. I've seen some turnarounds, but it's one of the most impressive I've seen.
27 runs on 25 hits in those last two games, and the Tigers club 8 home runs out of the ballpark there in Gainesville. Devin Fontenot looks ready to go. Monroe will send up the 1, 2, and 3 hitters to get things started here. Holt, Cupid, and Schultz. Mason Holt, the senior. Again, 3 seniors start this lineup for Coach Federico and the Warhawks. Devin ready to fire, delivers, and it misses a tad outside with a fastball, and we are underway. Time of first pitch, 6:32 Central Time, and it's 1-0 to Mason Holt. Again, beautiful weather here today. Game day forecast currently 79 degrees here in the capital city. The 1-0, did he go around? They'll say he did. And it will even up the count, 1-1. Game day forecast, as always, brought to you by AccuTemp. Chance of power outages never. Get a whole home generator from AccuTemp. Keep the power in your hands. 1-1 to Holt. We're just underway. Fontenot winds and delivers. Oh. And a swing and a miss. Off speed, and it's 1-2. Doug, you talked about Fontenot coming into the game, and as a former pitcher, a guy who has spent the majority of his time on the mound in relief, as we mentioned, this is just his 6th start. How do you approach it differently from what he's normally accustomed to coming out of the pen?
Pretty much the same routine, except for you get to long toss before the game. Now, that's the 0-2 pitch. I'm looking for that this game from Fontenot, the 1-2 and 0-2 when he's ahead. I like that slider falling out of the strike zone like that. That was a nice job from Holt to stay away.
2-2 now to the leadoff hitter for the Warhawks. Fontenot square to the plate, looks in. Now he'll wind, bring the 2-2 pitch, fouled back into the screen. And that's tonight's first foul ball, brought to you by Rotolo's Pizzeria. They've got the dough you really want. Come on in, have a drink or two while they fix you up something new. Slide into a Rotolo's near you. Slides right off the tongue. 2-2 to Holt.
You know, and Fontenot spent a lot of the fall in a starting spot. They were really looking at him hard for a weekend spot. I think that might still be in play.
2-2. The pitch from Fontenot, lifted high and deep to left center field, and this one is going to find the seats. Mason Holt with a solo home run to start the game, his 5th homer of the year in that leadoff spot. And it's 1-0 ULM right out of the gate here in the top of the first inning.
The next thought was Fontenot's just got to stay down tonight because that wind, Chris, is blowing right towards Tiger Stadium. And not that the wind aided that one, but he did get underneath it and up in the jet stream. But there was that two-strike pitch that was just right over the middle of the plate.
So Holt with the whole a solo home run makes it 1-0. That'll bring up Ryan Cupid now, a left-handed hitter, a senior, batting 321. Got four doubles, one triple on the year. Batting for the 57th time this season. Out of West Monroe, Louisiana, he'll take the first pitch and on the hands, but on the inside corner, 0-1. Monroe, a team that has played a very tough schedule. They have not shied away from taking on top competition. The 0-1. Again, right there on the inside corner at the belt, and it's 0-2. Another fastball from Fontenot. Two games against Ole Miss earlier this season. Had a three-game set with Missouri. One game was canceled. But it was a 4-3 win by Mizzou back on February 25th. They played again on Sunday, and Missouri got the 4-2 win over the Warhawks in Columbia. Trying to catch the outside corner. This one just misses from Fontenot, and it's 1-2.
I like that pitch. Trying to nibble on the outside corner. Just missed, about a ball off the plate.
Still in the driver's seat. Fontenot steps back on the rubber. Trying to shake off the solo home run to start the game. The 1-2 to Cupid on its way. Tried the inside corner this time. Just missed right at the knees, and it's 2-2.
Well, Travinsky was set up out there on the outside part of the plate again, and Fontenot missed right over the middle. Travinsky tried to hold the glove out there to show the home plate umpire that it crossed the heart of the plate, but just missed the call.
Two balls, two strikes. Cupid readies the bat. Infield playing straight up, and the 2-2 pitch. Low and inside. That'll fill the count now, 3-2. Another fastball from Fontenot just missing.
Yeah, we haven't seen a slider in this at-bat.
Cupid taking some time. Now we'll dig back in from the left side. Fontenot ready to work. Payoff delivery. Foul down the line, and we'll find the seats just beyond the third base dugout. Still three balls, two strikes. Zachary Edgins, our first base umpire. Veteran Mark Chapman at second base. Colby Vedrine at third. And Jordan Alvarado behind the plate calling the balls and strikes. So Fontenot to deliver a payoff pitch here with nobody out, down 1-0 on a solo home run by the leadoff hitter Mason Holt. 3-2. Just missed the outside corner. Looked good from here. Home plate umpire Alvarado, though, not giving it up. And Cupid will walk down with a base on balls and nobody out, runner on. Bring up Grant Schultz, another senior, the third baseman for the Warhawks.
You know, that might have been a hair off. Might have been that one that just nicks the line on the, you know, on the big league screen where they, on the big league games where they show you the strike zone. But I really liked the 1-2 pitch, and I felt like he missed that one. I thought he would give it to him if it were close there, but Jay Johnson going to come out to talk it over with Fontenot. Is that?
Trent Vittmeyer warming down in the bullpen, so Coach Johnson on his way out will bring the infield in. A little bit of trouble here to start the ball game for Devin Fontenot.
Yeah, not what you're hoping for, especially when there's a pitch count leash somewhat. And we think it's going to be 30, 35 pitches, you know, maybe up to 40, but he's already up to 13 with no outs in the first inning.
So now Alvarado, the home plate umpire, going out to hurry up this discussion. Coach Johnson still talking it over with Devin in the infield. Now it's all wrapped up. He'll head back to the first base dugout. Infield will take their respective positions. Again, Jacob Berry at third, Kay Doty at short, Jordan Thompson at second base, Trey Morgan at first for the Tigers. Dugas, Cruz, and DiGiacomo in the outfield left to right. Hayden Travinsky back-to-back starts behind the plate catching along with Devin Fontenot on the bump. So with a runner on, nobody out, and a 1-0 Monroe lead, we'll see Grant Schultz batting 319, 92nd at bat of the year. Another right-handed hitter. Fontenot going to turn and fire to first. He keep an eye on Cupid over there, who's 2 of 3 in stolen bases this year.
Yeah, they'll run a little bit, especially the bottom of their order. Or 6, 7, and 8.
Coach Johnson told us before the game, expect them to be very aggressive on the base pads. And Devin Fontenot, following the scouting report, going to try to keep Cupid close to the first base bag. So first time I've seen you since we arrived back from Gainesville. Friday night in the 8th inning, Coach Johnson switches Doty and Thompson. Cade now taking over at shortstop, Jordan Thompson at second base. And Doug, throughout that weekend after that late game one, as a ground ball comes down the line at third, Barry comes up, throws, and Thompson has to try and dig it out of the dirt. Can't do so. Everybody is safe at first and second.
Yeah, that's one of those examples of trying to do too much. Of course, you always want to get the lead runner, right? But on that particular play, I really think Barry had a better chance of getting the out at first base.
Had to dive towards the foul line just in front of the bag, then rise and turn the body throw to second. I think you're right. He may have had an easier step towards first to make that throw. As it turns out, runners are safe. Warhawks have runners first and second. Yeah, now we'll see Landon Cato, the cleanup hitter, come in. The DH batting 304 this season. But my point was, Doty and Thompson seem to find some comfort and played well this weekend in their new positions. There's a swing and a miss on a fastball from Fontenot, and it's 0-1.
Yeah, sometimes small little tweaks are all you need.
Thompson's got the great arm, and Coach Johnson said at second base it just slows the game down for him. Bigger margin of error throwing to first from second as opposed to the length, because Thompson's made, as that one's fouled off back behind the plate. He's made some great plays, great dives, great coverage out there at short, and then sometimes the throw gets a little wild. He's got an absolute cannon, but now he's got a little more time to take his time, get set, and throw to first. And again, as Jay Johnson said, K. Doty pretty much could play anywhere on the field and be successful. So that will be the lineup for the foreseeable future. Runners first and second, nobody out. Here's the 0-2. Into left center field, coming in. Dugas sliding on a knee, comes up with a grab. He'll wheel it back into second, and just getting back is Cupid. The throw a little left of second base coming in. Thompson had to slide over to make sure he grabbed it, and it just brought his foot off the bag. And our second base umpire, Mark Chapman, indicated it brought him off. But a great catch in left center on the run by Gavin Dugas. Records out number one.
Yeah, back to the Doty and Thompson conversation. I'll let you introduce this hitter first.
So with Cato retired, Michelle Artsberger, first baseman, a sophomore, batting 213, a left-handed hitter, will stand in. And runners remain first and second. 1-0, ULM with a solo home run to start this game. Fontenot trying to get out of trouble.
Nice pitch.
There's the breaking pitch for a strike right at the knees, and it's 0-1 to Artsberger.
So, and this is just my opinion. Remember, I was a pitcher. But Jordan Thompson has that big arm, and I think that he's gotten away with staying back there on that outfield grass, letting balls get to him, and just throwing them out with the big arm. And I think that puts a little pressure on his shortstop.
The 0-1 strike on the inside corner. Nice placement by Fontenot, and it's 0-2.
You know, today, shortstops, infielders are taught to charge through the ball, so your momentum is carrying your throw to first base. And Thompson really didn't do that, and it caught him on his heels a few times this year, so I do like the adjustment, and we'll see if it pays off.
0-2 the count to Artsberger, a left-hander. Runners remain first and second. Now time called. Stepping out will be the Warhawk first baseman.
Obviously, out at second base, it's not quite as important to charge through because you don't need to get rid of the ball as quick. But you have about 4.2 seconds from the time that ball comes off the batter's bat to get it over to first base.
The 0-2 pitch. Again, going after that inside corner, just missing. That time with a heater, and it's 1-2.
And to Fontenot's credit, he's not missing by much. Again, in my opinion, he was squeezed a little bit on the walk to Cupid. And that pitch could have gone either way right there.
Cupid at second, Schultz at first base. The 1-2 delivery. Swing and a miss. That time brought the heat. The 92-mile-an-hour fastball. Hartsberger, no chance to get around on it. First punch out of the night for Devin Fontenot. Brought to you by Super One Foods. Great quality at super low prices. And that records out number two of the inning. So still some work left to do. Colby DeVille, the shortstop, another senior in this lineup, batting 364. He's got three home runs, nine runs batted in. Will stand in from the right side.
Fontenot's up to 21 pitches now, but he's now one pitch away from getting out of this inning.
Looks back to second. The pitch to DeVille. Foul towards the Warhawk dugout, third base side. Another Rotolo's foul ball, and it's 0-1.
Hit that one off his knuckles.
A good bit out in front of that one. Almost had the full swing when he caught the baseball on the bat. DeVille will stand in, 0-1 the count. Setting up outside, Travinsky. The pitch is there but low. One ball, one strike. Tonight's game brought to you by the eight partners that represent Team LSU. Cox, McDonald's, Our Lady of the Lake, Planet Fitness, Rouse's Markets, Coca-Cola, People's Health, and Hancock Whitney. Two outs, a 1-1 count. Two men on for the Warhawks. Fontenot to the plate. Strike at the letters. Gets ahead 1-2. Tiger fans trying to lift up their senior right-hander here. See if he can close down the top of the first inning. Keep it just a 1-0 ULM lead. The 1-2 with the runners going, and it's right down the middle, called strike three. So after giving up the solo home run to start the game, Fontenot comes back with two punch outs to end it. The Warhawks get one run. They do it on two hits. They leave two men on. Tigers coming to the plate for the first time. Doty, Morgan, and Cruz when we return. Warhawks 1, Tigers nothing on the LSU Sports Radio Network. Head to the bottom of the first inning here at Alec Box Stadium. ULM wasting little time. Solo home run by Mason Holt to lead off the top of the first inning. Devin Fontenot would settle down. He put two men aboard, but finished with two punch outs. And a 1-0 Warhawk lead will send the Tigers to the plate for the first time tonight. Kate Doty to lead things off.
Geaux Doty leading the team with a 366 batting average. 2 points higher than Dylan Cruz.
So Michael Howe Junior right-hander, ready to work. First delivery to Doty. Misses outside. The fastball at 89. And it's 1-0.
Doty is fifth in the SEC in hits. He has 34 on the year.
1-0. Lifted in the air to left field. Giving chase is Cupid. It will drop down in front of the left fielder. And Doty with a leadoff single. And the Tigers have something going early here in the bottom half of the first inning. Doty, as you mentioned, fifth in the SEC, batting 391 just before that knock to left field. This weekend batted 308, was 4 of 13 with 4 runs scored. Again, was moved to the top of the order in that Florida series. Now we'll see Trey Morgan. Morgan picked up his first home run in Saturday's game against the Gators. Two-run blast to get it started there in the top of the first inning. Off-speed delivery from Howell, misses high, it's 1-0. And we've talked about it all year here at the box, Doug. You know he has the potential for power.
Oh, yeah.
It's almost like a long-range basketball shooter. You see that first shot go through the net, things start to come to you. We'll see if that happens for Morgan. He will lace one to right field, but it's a line drive right at Trace Henry, who moved about four steps to his left. He'll glove it for out number one. And, again, Morgan never gets cheated, always pounds the baseball. That one just right at the right fielder, recording out number one.
That ball was hit very hard.
Dylan Cruz, speaking of home runs, dimensions at Florida Ballpark in Gainesville, similar. 330 down the lines there in Gainesville, left and right. 380 in the power alleys and straight up 400 in center field. Here's a ground ball designated for a double play, but it goes through the legs of DeVille, the shortstop. Cade Doty never stopped running after it got by the ULM infielder. He makes his way to third. Dylan Cruz will safely make it to first. So with one out, the Tigers, runners on the corners. That was a tailor-made double play right at the shortstop. And maybe just took his eye off of it, went right by his glove. He didn't get his body in front of it. Had a little ole attempt at the ground ball. Comes up empty, and the error going to allow the Tigers apply some pressure here on Michael Howe. But Dylan Cruz took one left of the batter's eye. It had to be at least 395, if not more. They didn't have TrackMan services at Florida, so we didn't get the total data on it. But he smoked one, a cruise missile to say the least. That'll bring to the plate now Jacob Berry. Another off-speed delivery, and it's a called strike to make it 0-1.
Yeah, DeVille just, his eyes got too big. He forgot to catch the ball first. As you mentioned, that was a tailor-made double play, a big break for the Tigers.
Doty at third, Cruz at first. Here's a base hit through the four hole into right field. Doty will come in to score, tie the game at one apiece. An RBI single off the bat of Jacob Berry. On the year, giving RBI number 26. And the Tigers getting early contact here, Doug, against Michael Howell.
Yeah, Doty got one off the hands. Morgan hit a laser out to right field. Cruz's ball wasn't hit particularly hard, but Berry hit that one about as hard as you can through that three hole.
So now that will bring up to the plate Jordan Thompson. Thompson this weekend, good work at the plate against the Gators, batted 417 in the series. Saw the baseball very well in Gainesville. Howell misses outside. Breaking pitch, it's 1-0.
Yeah, he and Joe Bear were on fire.
Tie game, 1-1. Runners first and second for LSU. Just one out. Pitch to Thompson. Fastball missing low from Howell, and it's 2-0.
Thompson 5 of 12 over the weekend with a couple doubles. Scored four runs.
Runners take their lead. The 2-0 pitch. Sails outside. 3-0 now the count. Tigers' speed, while not stolen bases, were the order against Florida. Doug, they were very effective beating out double play balls with their speed down the first base line. Thompson did it a couple of times. He'll take this pitch for ball four and earn the walk, and that'll load the bases for LSU here in the bottom of the first.
Friday night guy for Florida. You've seen a lot of SEC baseball now. Where does he stack up in the great ones that we've seen come through, not only LSU, but other teams as well.
He's the real deal. I mean, the left-hander, you know, hanging around 92, 93 miles an hour, had a really good off-speed pitch that kept LSU at bay. But, you know, he's not the most imposing figure. I think he stands 6'2", 6'3", but he's of that Florida great pitching vein that they had. But, you know, if there's one thing that surprised me is this first pitch comes into Joe Bear, a called strike on the inside corner. After Hunter Barco, I think Kevin O'Sullivan would be honest and say they've got some work to do as far as starting pitching. Bases loaded, the 0-1. Misses low and outside. Brandon Sproat was the starter on Saturday in game two, and he got roughed up a little bit by Alabama the week before, although Florida's bullpen came in and they were able to get that win in game two of the opening weekend.
They had a good big fastball, right?
Yeah. The Tigers able to hit him as well. Here's one laced to right center field off the bat of Joe Bear. That's going to bring in Cruz. They'll go ahead and send in Barry. They're going to go ahead and wave in Thompson. The throw just now coming into the infield. And a base-clearing double off the bat of Joe Bear, who adds to his RBI total, and the Tigers take a 4-1 lead. 9 ribbies on the weekend. How about 3 to get started this week?
Not a bad 4 games, 12 RBIs. That puts him at 32 on the year. And that's enough to lead the team.
Perfectly placed in the gap. Beautiful. In right center. Rolled all the way to the wall. Giving chase was Holt and Henry. The Tigers were off and running. Now we'll have time called, and ULM going to go out and visit with their starting pitcher now.
And that double, those 3 RBIs put Joe Bear in 3rd place in the SEC with 32.
Colton Childress handles the pitchers for Coach Frederico, and he's out there now visiting with the infield. Warhawks, no surprise, giving up 4 runs on 3 hits. Still just 1 out here in the bottom of the first. They'll get some action going down in the left field bullpen. A right-hander slowly tossing down there. It appears to be Henry Shuffler, redshirt freshman out of Lafayette.
Only 14 pitches thrown so far for Michael Howell. Again, a big guy, 6'7", 225, an imposing figure on the mound.
That'll bring up Gavin Dugas. Dugas on the weekend batted just 222, but drove in 3 runs. Runner at second. Here's the pitch, and a strike at the belt. Fastball touches 90 for Howell, and it's 0-1. Dugas and Joe Bear combining for back-to-back jacks there in Saturday's game 2 against the Gators. The 0-1. Breaking ball misses outside. 1 ball and 1 strike. Coach Jay Johnson last night, Doug, on his weekly radio show, was asked about the top of the order, top 4, 5 in the order. Here's the 1-1 down in the dirt, blocked up by Matthew Lee, the Warhawk catcher. Talking about, could you use a guy like DiGiacomo with his speed to kind of get things started at the top of the order? And Coach Johnson was very forthcoming about when you have the lineup that you have in the front 4 right now, depending on the order, Doty, Morgan, Cruz, and Barry, you want a guy that can affect the bottom of the order like DiGiacomo. Here's a bouncer off the bat of Dugas over a leaping Schultz at third, down the line in left, coming in to score from second is going to be Joe Bear. The throw into second, Dugas slides safely under the tag, and he's got an RBI double, and the Tigers lead 5-1. And that's getting some production near the bottom of the order here tonight. And now we'll see the aforementioned Giovanni DiGiacomo. And before that, let's pause 10 seconds. Station identification on the LSU Sports Radio Network.
You know, that was a well-placed double down the line on the high chop over Schultz at third base, but Dugas never had a doubt in his mind around him first.
First pitch to Geo. Comes in high for ball 1.
And that was actually a bang-bang play when he was coming in there at second base, but we'll take it. Double-double. Everyone has reached base with the exception of Morgan, and he might have hit the hardest ball of the inning.
The 1-0. Off speed. misses off the outside corner. Two balls, no strikes. The Tigers, five runs on four hits after giving up the solo home run in the top of the first inning, wasting little time to tie it and then quickly take the lead. Still just one out, 2-0 to Geaux. Say a strike on the inside corner as Geaux had to slide out of the way. He doesn't like the call, but make it 2-1. Giovanni batting 286 on the year. He's got a runner at second with one out. The 2-1. Little slow bouncer, two-hopper to shortstop. DeVille throws to first but just barely beats DiGiacomo, who was humming down the first base line. That will move Dugas over to third base. But that's the way DiGiacomo can make what looks to be a somewhat routine play unroutine, as he was very close to beating that.
I'd like to see that on a little bit slower replay. We got it here on the monitor at regular speed, and it looked dang close. Might have got him off the cap of the bat there.
So now we'll see Hayden Travinsky. Travinsky, two home runs on the season, both coming in Gainesville this weekend. Here's a strike with a breaking ball from Howell, and it's 0-1. Dugas stands down at third. There's two outs, and the Tigers up 5-1.
Just got the replay, and maybe by a cleat, they had it.
The 0-1. Misses low with the fastball. One ball, one strike. Coach Jay Johnson told everyone before the game on Saturday, LSU had to be the aggressor at the plate. They certainly were for the rest of the weekend, as Travinsky takes a big swing, fouls it back into the screen. Another Rotolo's foul ball, and it's one ball, two strikes. And I think the question for all Tiger fans coming into this week, after pounding 27 runs on 25 hits, really bringing out the billy clubs in Gainesville, would they be able to continue that aggressive nature? Well, the good news is so far in this one they have. 1-2 to Travinsky. Big swing, but a chopping foul ball towards the third base dugout. Keeps it one ball, two strikes.
Yep, I'd say so far so good. Definitely what Jay Johnson's looking for after giving up that one run in the first. Talk about a way to respond.
The 1-2, breaking ball and fouled by Travinsky down the third baseline. He said the biggest improvement and what he loved most was the Tigers aggressive after pitches they could work with and spitting on those that in earlier games they had chased. He said that's a very good sign in his book. Two outs, runner at third. The 1-2, another ground ball foul, third base side. Coach Fitzgerald keeping an eye on Travinsky, who has been sending him down the third base line.
Notice how he's not in the box. Steadily moving backwards towards left field. I don't blame him.
Two outs, runner at third. The 1-2, another foul ball. This one straight down into the dirt. And Travinsky battling here against Michael Howe. Warhawks commit one error here. Dylan Cruz on a ground ball to short, got by DeVille. Then the Tigers started the hit parade. 1-2 pitch. Good eye by Travinsky. Miss maybe high. It's 2-2. Two-two delivery. And a smack and a one-hopper by a diving DeVille at shortstop finds its way into left field. And that will bring in another run. Dugas touches home plate. And it's 6-1 LSU. Travinsky picks up the hit, and that'll turn the order over. And we'll see Kate Doty come to bat for the second time. He picked up a base hit and scored to start the bottom of the first inning. And
ouch.
Now there's going to be a meeting again on the mound. Let's see. That'll be the hit.
Yep. That's the second time.
So Michael Howell will check out of the game here in the bottom of the first, and they'll make a pitching change. Powered by Sunshine, your hometown John Deere dealer in Louisiana. Tigers leading 6-1. They're not finished yet. Two outs, one man on as we scrimmage here in the bottom of the first inning. Tell you about the new Warhawk pitcher when we come back on the LSU Sports Radio Network. Fans, just like the winning lineup, Cintas has the all-star services for all your business needs, everything from uniforms to kitchens and restroom solutions. Get ready for the workday with Cintas. Tigers picking up where they left off this weekend thus far. We're still here in the bottom of the first inning, two outs. Tigers got down 1-0 after a solo home run to start the game in the top of the first by Mason Holt for the Warhawks. Tigers apparently took offense to that. Six runs on five hits so far for LSU. Here in the bottom of the first, Michael Howell, the starting pitcher for ULM, has been bounced. They now move and hand the baseball off to Henry Scheffler, who will take over and try to find the third out here in the bottom of the first inning.
Yeah, Scheffler is also 6'7", 225 pounds. Out of Lafayette, Louisiana, went to Episcopal School, Acadiana. He's a redshirt freshman.
Runner at first in Travinsky, and the first pitch offered up to Kay Doty. Swung on and fouled back into the screen. It's 0-1.
This is Scheffler's fifth appearance. He's been a starter in his first four. He's got a 1-2 record with an 11.25 ERA.
Pitch from Scheffler, misses high for ball one. One ball, one strike. Again, Doty with the base hit to lead off the bottom of the first inning. Came around to score the first run for the Tigers. One of six so far plated. Pitch to the plate. Breaking ball in for a strike, and it's 1-2.
Scheffler's had a rough go of it in eight innings. 11 hits allowed, 10 earned runs, 11 walks, and 8 strikeouts. Opponents hitting 344. 2 6-foot-7 right-handers. Interesting.
The 1-2 pitch to Doty. Breaking ball swung on and popped up onto the infield grass. Hartsberger, the first baseman near the mound, will call for it, make the play for out number three. But the Tigers get started as well. Six runs on five hits, one error committed by ULM. We go to the top of the second inning. 6-1. Your Fighting Tigers lead. Back after this on the LSU Sports Radio Network. Fans, if you want a little fun, then play Sapphire Sevens from the lottery. You could win up to $20,000. Stop at any lottery retailer. Pick up Sapphire Sevens today for your chance to win up to 20 grand. Pick up your tickets today and get your shine on. Must be at least 21 to purchase. 6-1 LSU leads. Top of the second inning. Warhawks come to the plate for the second time. 7, 8, and 9 hitters due up. Washburn, Henry, and Lee for Coach Federico.
Yeah, and the Tigers are going to go out there with Trent Wittmeyer in the second inning, so that's going to do it for Fontenot. He works the inning. There's 25 pitches. They want to have him fresh for the weekend. He allowed 2 hits, 1 earned run. He had a walk and 2 strikeouts. And Trent Wittmeyer will now toe the rubber for the 8th appearance of the season. He enters with a 1.59 ERA and 11 and a third. Trent has allowed 5 hits, 2 earned runs. He has 4 walks and 12 strikeouts.
Washburn stands in from the left side, and Wittmeyer delivers a strike. And it's 0-1. We saw Wittmeyer Saturday night. 8 pitches thrown to close the door on Florida in that 16-4 win in game 2. The 0-1 fastball right by him, swing and a miss, and it's 0-2.
You know, Wittmeyer's really been solid his whole career. This is his, I want to say, his 74th career appearance. Let me check that.
Here's the 0-2 delivery. Another fastball, swing and a miss. Washburn down on strikes, and Wittmeyer fans the first batter he faces. Records out number 1, the strikeout. Brought to you by Super One Foods. Great quality at super low prices. And got the breaking ball to go ahead 0-1, then challenged him with 2 heaters. And a swing and a miss on those 2 pitches results in out number 1. And we'll see Henry come to the plate, batting in the 8th spot, hitting 218 on the year.
Yes, this is the 74th career appearance for Wittmeyer.
On the outside corner with a breaking ball, and he gets ahead again, 0-1. By the way, we failed to mention Devin Fontenot with the appearance, that one inning of work, his 100th appearance as an LSU Tiger in his career. The 0-1. This time the heater misses outside. 1 ball, 1 strike. Trace Henry out of Moorville, Mississippi. Bats from the right side. Wittmeyer, the 1-1, fouled off and into the screen right side. 1 ball, 2 strikes. Fans, this inning brought to you by AccuTemp Services. Don't let AC or heater outages keep you on the bench this year. All you have to do is text the word home run, 2 words actually, to 31996 and get your Tiger tune-up. AccuTemp Services, proud partner of LSU Athletics. Wittmeyer ahead in the count, 1 ball, 2 strikes, the pitch, and staying alive as Henry fouls it back into the screen on that fastball offering. Still 1 ball, 2 strikes. Wittmeyer, quite the jokester, too.
Yeah.
Had to enjoy sitting with the guys about halfway near the back of the plane there and back. And Wittmeyer, I had the pleasure of sitting in front of him. And
a little prank on you there?
Not on me, just on some of the teammates. And a little jokester. Pretty funny. Got me to laugh a few times, so made the flights enjoyable.
Yeah, he's the leader in the clubhouse, that's for sure.
One ball, 2 strikes. One out here in the top of the second in a 6-1 LSU lead. The pitch lifted towards the alley in right center, giving chase as Cruz on the run, diving, and he will hold on for out number 2. Fully extended Superman out in right center. And Dylan Cruz flashing the leather and some style.
Well, we get a replay here, but I could watch this one all night. You watch a guy sell out, and that is pure selling out right there in the right center gap. Robbed a sure double off the bat of Trace Henry. Dude, he had to run a long way to get to that ball. Wow. What can't he do?
Got up as if it's just another routine play.
I would still be out there fighting for a breath.
Asking for oxygen. Exactly. Here's Matthew Lee, the catcher. First delivery from Vittmeyer. Fastball low and outside. It's 1-0. Lee batting for just the sixth time on the season. Look for his first hit in 2022. Vittmeyer has other ideas, of course, with two outs. Vittmeyer fires off speed, way out in front. Swing and a miss. It's 1-1.
Yeah, I'd just about now be getting up off the ground if I went out there and gave you a full Superman and landed on this belly. It'd take me a few minutes.
With maybe some assistance?
Definitely some assistance. Corey Couture would have to be out there coaching me up. That was impressive.
Here's the 1-1 delivery. Missing high from Vittmeyer off speed, and it's 2-1.
That's got to be a top 10 play. Got to be.
I would look for it tonight, later on this evening.
Jeez.
Here's the 2-1 delivery. Fastball right down Skip Bertman Drive, evens a count 2-2.
You know, it's a funny game, but you see some patterns every now and again, and can't tell you how many times I've seen a guy make a great play like that, come in and hit, let's see, second the next inning and hit a ball hard. So maybe we'll see if that stands true.
Two outs. Here's the 2-2 delivery. Ooh, this fastball got loose. Gets away from Travinsky all the way to the backstop. That'll fill the count 3-2. You know, it's interesting. It was fun talking to Coach Jay Johnson last night about how he utilizes the data and analytics. Said he kind of goes right down the middle. He uses the information. He thinks it helps the kids, helps the players understand the trends. He said, but what I found is that gut baseball feeling, a lot of time the analytics will back that up. The 3-2,
yep. Oh,
misses low, just below the knees, and Vittmeyer will give up the two-out walk, and that'll put Lee at first base and send us back to the top of the order for the Warhawks, and Mason Holt, who had the solo home run to get ULM on the board.
Yeah, I think the data, all the analytics are great to confirm things that we've known for 150 years, first of all. And then secondly, I do think that they maybe lead you to certain trends and patterns, but at the end of the day, you got to go out there and see how hard your pitcher's breathing, and there's no analytics to tell you that. So I hear what he's saying.
Lee with a leadoff first base. Holt awaits, and the pitch missing outside. Ball one with a fastball, 1-0. Lee, by the way, looking for his first hit, but he is 1-for-1 in stolen bases, and he's taking a pretty lengthy lead off of first base.
I don't know that anyone has really gone all in yet on the analytics. There's still some decision making to do without it.
The 1-0 from Vittmeyer, strike, make it one ball, one strike. And it's interesting as well, we've been talking about some of the technology that LSU has been employing for a number of years now, and there are still some top programs that may surprise you that are not.
That don't have it, that's right.
One recent opponent comes to mind, the 1-1. High in the air to right field to Giacomo. Settling under it, and he'll grab it for out number 3. So the Warhawks are done here in the top of the second inning. No runs, no hits. They do leave one man on. We go to the bottom of the second inning here at the box. Your Fighting Tigers leading 6-1 over ULM. Morgan, Cruz, and Barry do up when we return on the LSU Sports Radio Network. 6-1 our score, LSU leading over ULM. Warhawks took a 1-0 lead in the top of the first. The Tigers would answer with 6 runs on 5 hits. And they come to the plate for the second time tonight. Trey Morgan, followed by Dylan Cruz and Jacob Berry, 2, 3, and 4 hitters. Coach Jay Johnson and the Tigers. Fans get low-rate, long-term financing right now on powerful Kubota tractors, mowers, and utility vehicles. Visit LSUKubotaDealers.com for your nearest Kubota dealer. Test drive a Kubota today. Morgan smoked one to right field, but right at the ULM right fielder. May have been the hardest hit ball of that bottom of the first, but he came away empty-handed. This one fouled back on the first offering into the screen. It's 0-1 to Morgan. Trey this weekend went 4-for-13 with 3 runs scored. Did have that, again, first home run of the season, deep to right center field on Saturday in game 2. The 0-1 pitch. Whoa, that may have hit the mascot. Got loose that time from Scheffler and probably missed the plate and the batter's box.
Yeah, I think it might have got the edge of the right-handed batter's box.
The 1-1.
There's a better
one. Misses off the corner. Outside, 2-1. I think that one came right over the L in the LSU behind the plate. Here's the 2-1 to Morgan. Look out.
Watch out.
Down in the dirt. Morgan has to skip out of the way, and it's now 3-1 as that fastball 91 miles an hour from Henry Scheffler.
Yeah, these guys got a little bruised up again this weekend. They were hit by, was it 8 pitches Saturday?
That's it. Watch out, and that one's going to catch Trey Morgan. So he will head on down to first base. Yeah, with Sunday's game 3, 8-hit batters. Florida gave up no free passes in walks, but 8-hit batters.
Wow.
And another interesting discussion while we have a moment that I really felt odd after last night's show. Jay Johnson was talking about the 8-hit batters, and he told the guys, hey, look, we won the free base war. And I said, oh, coach, never heard that term before. And he said, yeah, free base war. He said, my football background with my father being a football coach, I look at the free passes like a turnover battle. And when you win it, chances are you're going to win the game.
I love that analogy. It's spot on.
Dylan Cruz takes the first pitch, misses outside, 1-0. And then Todd Poleads immediately went to work last night.
Yeah, tell me where this 61-hit batsman stands, 62 now.
Here's the 1-0. Cruz swings, lifts it into right field. Shallow right near the line. Henry coming over and just in foul territory. Maybe one step there, he's able to haul it in for out number one. But here's the number that was amazing because Jay Johnson, again, talking about how winning the free base war will win you baseball games. Todd went back and looked. Since 1997, LSU baseball, +5 or higher in that category. The Tigers' winning percentage is 9-3-6. That's 450 wins to 31 losses, including so far this year, 9-0 when they win the quote-unquote turnover battle in 2022.
Makes so much sense.
One down, and we'll see Jacob Berry. And first, a throw over to keep an eye on Morgan at first base. Berry had a base hit with an RBI, sent one into right field, his first time up.
Yeah, we're 24 games into this year. The Tigers have already been hit 62 times. Again, last year, 69.
This one misses
63
low.
63 games.
That's an amazing number.
And we've been, since the first weekend, it seems like, we've been talking about how many times they've been hit this year. Thought it was something maybe just, you know, unusual, but something to it.
The 1-0 to Berry. Misses just high above the letters. 2 balls, no strikes.
I'd like to know from Todd Poleads, what's the most hit batsman in a season?
Get ready. I imagine it's coming soon.
That's what I'm hoping for.
Runner at first and Morgan. The 2-0 delivery. Berry stays back, and the pitch across the plate makes it 2-1. I sent that number to Coach Johnson last night. He said, well, that's getting some information quickly. I said, yeah, that's one of the things that Todd does. The 2-1.
Watch out.
Misses inside. Berry having to back up, and it's now 3 balls and 1 strike. again, one of those situations where the analytics and the data match up with a gut feeling. Here's a chopping ground ball. Going up for it is Artsberger. At first, he'll bring it down, step on the bag, then throw to second, and they'll get the double play to end it for LSU here in the bottom of the second. Had to go all the way up, reach up, and Artsberger brought it down and then landed on the first base bag, giving him the time he needed to make the throw to second for the twin killing. So the Tigers finished here in the bottom of the second inning. We head now to the top half of the third. Fighting Tigers lead ULM 6-1. Warhawks come to the plate next on the LSU Sports Radio Network. Tiger fans, remember StubHub, the easiest way to experience every Tiger game. You can check the virtual view, score your seats, then get your tickets delivered instantly. StubHub, the official ticket marketplace of LSU Athletics. StubHub, be there. Doug Thompson, we talk about it all the time. We love watching baseball on the diamond, but one of our favorite parts here at the ballpark is the military salutes. Oh, yeah. And tonight, Lieutenant John Brooks of the United States Navy honored between innings. Nice hand from the crowd here at Alec Box Stadium. Thank to Lieutenant Brooks for his service. Wittmeyer continues here his second inning of the work. Cupid will lead things off here. 2, 3, and 4 due up for the Warhawks. First pitch missing from Wittmeyer. Here's the 1-0. Got a little crossed up on that breaking ball. Gets loose from Travinsky. It's 2-0. Cupid, a walk back in the first inning, left stranded at second base. Jacob Berry playing in on the infield grass down the line at third to the left-handed hitter, and the 2-0 swung on and sent back into the screen. Another Rotolo's foul ball. Good crowd here on a Tuesday night. Non-conference midweek baseball, hoping to have a rowdy crowd this weekend when Auburn rolls in. The 2-1, big swing, but foul back out of play over the third base dugout. Now 2-2 the count.
You know, Wittmeyer's another guy you probably want to have somewhat fresh this weekend. Maybe thinking of him for Saturday or Sunday. Let him get 4 or 5 innings tonight.
2-2. Just missed off the outside corner with that fastball to Cupid. And it's now a full count, 3-2. Again, you talk about how big that series was at Florida for Coach Johnson and the Tigers. There's the 3-2 delivery missing high from Wittmeyer for ball four. And that will put Cupid aboard at first here with nobody out in the top of the third. Going into the weekend, the Tigers We're in the bottom of the SEC West. Again, with Ole Miss being swept by Tennessee at home. Alabama still struggling at 2-4 in the season. The Tigers jumped into third place behind Arkansas and Auburn with that 3-3 mark. In fact, Auburn's 3-3 in SEC play, which makes this weekend series even more interesting to watch. Again, a team that kind of hangs its hat this year on offense. Here's a swing and a miss to Schultz. Chases one away, and it's 0-1.
Yeah, the series this weekend include Vanderbilt at South Carolina. Oops, excuse me, that was last weekend. This weekend, Georgia at Kentucky, Mississippi State will be at Alabama. Wait a minute.
The 0-1 misses outside. One ball, one strike.
No, Chris, that's all last weekend. Come on. Get it together. This weekend, A&M will be at Alabama. Mississippi State,
there you go,
will be at Arkansas.
Florida and Georgia, I know, get
Florida
together.
Florida and Georgia will get together in Athens.
The 1-1 swung on and foul back behind us. Now 1-2, the count to Schultz.
Ole Miss will do battle in Lexington against the Wildcats. South Carolina will travel to Missouri. And Tennessee and Vanderbilt. That's going to be a good matchup. How about Tennessee's schedule with Ole Miss and Vandy back-to-back?
Yep. Not much has stopped Tennessee this year.
No.
So we'll see if Vanderbilt's pitching staff can slow him down. The 1-2 misses high from Bittmeyer. Now two balls, two strike. Runner at first. Nobody out. Top of the third. LSU up 6-1 here this Tuesday night.
Well, I think it may be safe to say, or a safe assumption, that if they come out of Vanderbilt 9-0, they could start booking rooms in Omaha out in Knoxville.
2-2 delivery from Bittmeyer. Got him to chase. The fastball just off the outside corner, swing and a miss by Schultz. He's down on strikes. Records out number one. And we'll bring up Cato now in the cleanup spot. He's 0-1. He flied out to left field on a great sliding catch by Dugas.
Was it too early for that talk still?
It's a long SEC season.
It is long.
Marathon, not a sprint. Here's the first pitch offered up to Cato, and it's a called strike in on the belt, and it's 0-1. Yep. However, you're to your point,
wins,
to your point, that's a pretty tough opening schedule in league play.
I mean, starting out 6-0 is pretty darn impressive.
Quick throw over to first, back safely is Cupid. Still 0-1 the count to Cato.
See where everybody's ranked this week.
But my argument would be, again, just to play devil's advocate, first the 0-1 pitch and a high fastball, swing and a miss, and it's 0-2, while Tennessee may get off currently to a 6-0 start. You look at Ole Miss, a team that we know is loaded with talent, and their tough schedule, again, even with Tennessee at home, I don't know if it's too soon to say Ole Miss is not going to make it. We've seen so much change in the months of April and May headed down the stretch. This one just missed the outside corner. That'll move the count 1-2 with that breaking ball from Bittmeyer, but a great 0-2 pitch. Cato just good eye at the plate.
And I'm looking at these scores, and man, the SEC's got so many high-ranked teams, and my eyes slip to the eighth-ranked team in the country, which is Texas. There's a strikeout. Is that looking?
Yeah, Cato down on strikes for out number two. So Bittmeyer.
There's a little trouble here at home plate.
Yep, they're going to come out. Federico wants to talk with the home plate umpire, Jordan Alvarado. And again, a friendly discussion, it appears. And now the ULM coach going to backpedal his way to the third base dugout.
They're just. It was a check swing. I don't know what happened there, to be honest with you.
So with two down,
not sure what the argument was about.
Artsberger, the first baseman, left-handed hitter, takes a big cut, but comes up empty. It's 0-1.
But anyway, I was going to say, I see the eighth-ranked team in the country. I thought it was an SEC school, but nope, that's Texas. That's next year. How much better does the conference get when that happens?
The 0-1 fouled back into the screen. Yeah, it makes the strong even stronger.
Jeez.
0-2, the count now to Artsberger, who was a strikeout victim to Fontenot back in the first, one of two to finish that top of the first inning. 6-1 our score. Tigers 6 runs on 5 hits. The Warhawks 1 run on 2 hits and 1 error. Travinsky sets outside to the left-handed hitter. The pitch is right there, but just off the plate. It'll make it 1-2.
Is that a done deal with Texas that they're joining the conference?
Oh, yeah.
Which division?
No, they haven't revealed how the divisions will look.
That's going to be interesting.
At least not publicly. Here's a throw over. Morgan thought he had him. I've heard different theories and different thoughts on how that will work.
I think they should both join the East. We're overcrowded here in the West.
Two outs, runner at first. Again, Vittmeyer will throw over, this time getting back safely as Cupid. Well, Todd Poleads delivers. LSU's single-season hit-by-pitch record, 110. Back in 2000 in 69 games. Now that's going back to keeping that record since 1995. And if you're interested, the NCAA record is 152 hit-by-pitches by Delaware State in 2012. Here's one high and foul down the line in right.
That was 2010, you said?
For LSU?
Yeah.
2000.
Okay, 2000, the national championship team. They hit 340 as a team that year, which is unbelievable. And how many? 110?
Yep.
These guys are going to go way past 110.
Trending in that direction, sure. Runner at first, two outs. And again, Vittmeyer will throw to the first base bag and Cupid back safely. Vittmeyer trying to complete his second inning of work tonight. Looks like a right-hander ready to go for LSU down in the right field bullpen. Artsberger at the plate, a 1-2 count with two outs. Here's the 1-2 pitch, and just off the end of the bat, stays alive with a foul ball. Still 1-2.
I think that's Bryce Collins. But he's covering his numbers, so I can't really tell.
This is when we need our football eagle-eyed spotter, Jim Nickel, up here in the booth with us.
He would love to have Jim.
He would have that number in a heartbeat. Here's the 1-2. Another foul ball, a little bouncer, first base side. Keeps Vittmeyer ahead in the count. One ball, two strikes. Fans, Super One Foods has super low prices on all your game day favorites. Up your grocery game and score big with Super One Foods.
It's neither. It's Kale Lansville, actually, who I'd really like to see pitch again, so this is good.
Cupid with a leadoff first. Two outs for the Warhawks here in the top half of the third inning. Vittmeyer from the stretch, the 1-2. Missed inside. Two balls, two strikes. Artsberger, one of three lefties in the lineup for the Warhawks tonight. Two outs, runner on at first. 2-2 delivery. Missing outside will fill the count with the breaking ball, 3-2. Vittmeyer with the payoff delivery. Runner goes, and it's fouled back out of play. Another Rotolo's foul ball. Swinging at the fastball offering from Vittmeyer. Still 3-2. Mike, Tigers have Auburn at home this weekend in SEC play and head out again next weekend to Starkville to take on Mississippi State at Duty Noble. Runner goes, 3-2 pitch, off speed, upstairs, swing, and a miss. Hartsberger chased it, eye level. Down on strikes, Wittmeyer records another punch out. Powered and brought to you by Super One Foods, great quality at super low prices, and the Warhawks are done. We head to the bottom of the third inning, LSU leading 6-1 over ULM. Back after this on the LSU Sports Radio Network. Remember, fans, TJ Ribs, the official barbecue restaurant of LSU Athletics, proudly serving the greater Baton Rouge area their famous barbecue since 1986. TJ Ribs, the reason for ribs. 6-1 our score, LSU leading ULM on this Tuesday night. Bottom of the third inning, Tigers will have Thompson, Joubert, and Dugas, 5, 6, and 7 hitters. Zach Shaw will take over on the mound for ULM, third pitcher of the night for Coach Federico and the Warhawks. Thompson stands in, earned a base on balls, came around to score in that first inning. First pitch, right back up the middle, ground ball near second, backhanded by Washburn. The throw to first and a nice stretch by Hartsberger will get Thompson for out number one.
Zach Shaw, a 6'3", 230-pound right-hander, a freshman out of Wachita Parish High School in Monroe. Shaw enters the game for the eighth time this year with a 4.38 ERA. He's worked 12 and a third, allowed 9 hits, 6 earned runs. He has 2 walks and 10 strikeouts.
Braden Joubert stands in. Joubert had the base-clearing double, driving in 3 runs his last time up back in the first inning. First pitch down at the ankles and inside, it's 1-0.
Joubert with a dozen RBIs in the last 4 games. Has to wear batting gloves. That bat is so hot.
Up his average now to 321 as the 1-0 pitch comes in, and a line drive. Diving for it on one hop is going to be Hartsberger. He will flip to Shaw covering at first to get Joubert, but a hot shot right at first base. And good play by Hartsberger. Nice initial reaction going for it. Maybe thinking his lucky stars, that one didn't skip under the glove, but he's able to knock it down and then pick it up. It's pitcher covering at first, and there's 2 gone.
Also lost the sunglasses there, but of course not a big deal because it is nighttime out here.
I see you lost yours too. You put yours down 2 innings ago, though.
Way
I'll
before.
Give you credit.
Yeah. It looks good on his hat, though.
Gavin Dugas stands in with 2 down. Gavin also part of that hit parade, had a double with an RBI. First pitch missing low and away. 1 ball, no strikes. Dugas now batting an even 300. The 1-0 skips the plate low. It's ball two. Two-oh delivery inside, just misses Gavin. And it's three balls, no strikes. Two guys batting 350 with two outs in the inning this year. 3-0 pitch. There's a strike. Dugas thought it was ball four, but he will backpedal his way to the right side of the batter's box, and it's 3-1. With two outs, Shaw delivers, and there's a strike to fill the count up, 3-2.
I feel like he called that one because he took a few steps on the last one.
Payoff delivery. This one a mile high down the line in left. If this ball stays fair, it's gone, and it is. Round tripper for Gavin Dugas. Third homer of the year, and the Tigers make it 7-1.
That's what I like to see. We've talked about it 100 times, Chris. If the Tigers can get even half the production as they did last year from Gavin Dugas, this season may last all the way through the end of the College World Series. He's starting to heat up.
Bet he's real happy that was called strike one with that 3-0 count.
And strike two.
Giovanni DiGiacomo will stand in. So a home run with two outs here. Plates a run in the bottom of the third. Sixth hit of the night for LSU. First delivery, strike at the belt, and it's 0-1. Giacomo grounded out to the shortstop, DeVille. On a close play at first, back in that first frame, the 0-1 delivery. Missing low and outside with the breaking ball, it's 1-1. The 1-1 from Shaw, there's a strike. Giacomo thought it was going to miss outside, but the fastball makes it 1-2. The wind and delivery. Shaw delivers the 1-2 pitch. Called strike on the inside corner to Giacomo down on strikes. Shaw records his first punch out in relief, and that'll do it for LSU. However, they add to their lead. One home run down the left field line by Gavin Dugas. One run on one hit. They leave nobody on. We go to the top of the fourth. 7-1 Fighting Tigers. This is the LSU Sports Radio Network. Seven to one LSU on top of ULM here on this Tuesday night midweek affair. Top of the fourth inning. Warhawks coming to the plate. Cal Lansville take over on the mound for the Tigers. Third pitcher of the night for Coach Jay Johnson. Devin Fontenot worked one inning to start the game, gave up two hits. One run, it was a solo shot to left center field. two strikeouts, one walk. Bittmeyer, two innings of work. No runs, no hits, two walks, four strikeouts. Now Lansville takes over. Jones to lead it off, and the first pitch, a mile high and deep down the line in left, but this one is foul, left of the pole down in left. Lansville, happy to see that one veer to the left down the line. Long fly ball foul off the bat. Carson Jones out of Monroe, Louisiana. He'll come back, pick up the bat, dig back in from the right side. Jones, the shortstop, batting for the first time. Inserted in at short for DeVille. So a change for the Warhawks as he pops this one straight up. Could be playable. Travinsky giving chase near the third base dugout. But this one will just catch the overhang out of play. Another Rotolo's foul ball, and it moves the count. One ball, two strikes. Jones with his 45th at bat here. Bill, the senior, got the start. Jones, the sophomore, now batting in the sixth spot. One ball, two strikes. Lansville winds and delivers the 1-2. Missing low, evens the count, two balls, two strikes. Here's the 2-2 pitch. Missing low, and that'll fill the count 3-2. Doug, you mentioned you excited to see Lansville take the mound once again, his fifth appearance on the year.
Yeah, I've liked what I've seen from him. That fastball definitely plays here. He's got a nice off-speed pitch to go with it.
Payoff delivery, Jones awaits. Lansville fires, and it's lifted in the air to center field. Coming in is Dylan Cruz. He will settle under it. Have it for out number one. So Jones retired. They'll bring Washburn to the plate, who's 0 for 1 tonight.
And for the second time tonight, the Tigers get the leadoff runner out.
Washburn, a strikeout victim to Wittmeyer, his first time up in the second inning. One of four tonight.
Yeah, Wittmeyer punched out the side there in the third inning.
Showing bunt down the first base line, drops it down, picked up by Lansville, and couldn't beat it out. The throw was late. Lansville trying to get the right angle and get the proper arm slot to throw as he was nearly behind the runner down the first base line. So Washburn pulls out the bunt, lays it down successfully, and with one out, Warhawks have a runner aboard.
It's one way to get on. Just a little risky, I think, down by six runs.
So Washburn down at first base. Four for five in stolen bases. He'll take a healthy leadoff first as Trace Henry stands in. And Lansville will throw over. Gets away from Morgan. Washburn hops up on his way to second. He'll go in there standing.
Actually got a piece of the foot of first base umpire Zachary Edgins, which might have helped a little bit, keeping that ball closer to Morgan.
So the runner advances to scoring position on the throwing error by Lansville with one out. Trace Henry now at the plate with a runner in scoring position. Lansville fires and misses outside with a fastball, 1-0. Fans H&E Equipment Services, the official construction equipment partner of LSU Athletics. For all your rental needs, call 877-700-RENT or visit herentals.com today. 1-0 the count. The pitch, Chopping ground ball towards short. Toady comes in, trying to backhand on the short hop. Gets away from him. Everybody safe first and third. Big Baltimore chop in front of the plate. Went high in the air. Took an extra two bounces. Doty playing deep in the hole. Had to charge in. Couldn't get to it on the fly. Had to take it on that second short hop.
Wouldn't have mattered. Even if he was able to glove it cleanly, no chance he would have been able to get Trace Henry. That ball was up there a good 30 feet in the air. This is the hardest I've seen the wind blow out to center field so far this season.
So an infield single by Henry puts runners on the corners now. And the bottom of the order, Matthew Lee. Got a walk, his first at bat, still looking for his first hit of the year. He'll show bunt, but he fouls it back into the screen. On the fastball from Lansville, it's 0-1. Warhawks down 7-1 here to LSU, top of the fourth inning. And again, Coach Federico trying to manufacture runs any way possible here. Just one out in the inning. Runners again, first and third. Lee again shows bunt and again will pop it up behind the plate and into the screen. He's now 0-2. One out and an 0-2 count. Lansville trying to keep it a 7-1 lead. They'll try to lay down the bunt. They will. First base side. Lansville will pick it up. His only play is to Thompson covering at first base. Coming in to score will be Washburn. And the Warhawks get it done to make it 7-2. LSU by five runs. I would say that's determined to get the run in.
Yeah, and at this point in the game, you know, up six runs, you'll definitely trade a run for an out. You have to lay down an awful lot of bunts to come from behind six runs, though.
You are correct. To the top of the order, Mason Holt. Holt batting for the second time tonight, had the solo home run in the first inning, flied out to right field his last time up in the second. Lansville brings the fastball up and in, and it's 1-0. Runner at second base with two outs and the 1-0. Sent back foul into the screen. One ball, one strike, 7-2 LSU leads, top of the fourth. Holt spent 2 years at Navarro College in Texas before making his way to Monroe and ULM. The 1-1, big swing and a miss. Looking for the fences again, couldn't get around on the fastball from Lansville, and it's 1-2. Transferring into Monroe. Holt was the pretty much everyday center fielder in last season. Henry with a short leadoff second. Lansville checks the runner. Now the 1-2. Ground ball smoked but foul down the third baseline. Keeps the count one ball, two strikes. Fans, when the Tigers win, you win. Enter promo code LSU50 the day after an LSU baseball victory. And you will receive 50% off your online order at PapaJohns.com. Better ingredients, better pizza, Papa John's. Two outs in the inning, runner at second base, and a 1-2 count to Mason Holt. Lansville fires to the plate, and again lifted high and deep to left field, giving chase is Dugas, and it is gone. Second home run for Mason Holt tonight. That's home run number 6 on the year. That'll make it a 7-3 ball game now as Monroe trying to inch their way back in this one. Fifth hit of the night for the Warhawks.
Well, I guess if you're going to do that, the bunts won't hurt too bad.
While we have a moment, let's pause 10 seconds. Station identification. This is Fighting Tiger Baseball on the LSU Sports Radio Network. Back inside the Caesar Sportsbook broadcast booth, two outs here in the top half of the fourth inning, and Louisiana Monroe, after coming into the inning down 7-1, now have plated 3 runs here in the top of the fourth. Mason Holt with his second home run of the ball game will bring us now to Ryan Cupid. First pitch from Lansville, a called strike. It's 0-1. The 0-1 delivery. Hit into the air, down the line at third. Foul territory. Jacob Berry settles under it. He will have it for out number 3, but not before. The Warhawks show a little life here in the top of the fourth. They plate 3 runs on 3 hits. 1 throwing error by the Tigers. And it's a 7-4 LSU lead. Bottom of the fourth coming your way. Tigers will have the bottom of the order. Travinsky followed by Doty and Morgan when we return on the LSU Sports Radio Network. Couple of home runs in tonight's game by the Warhawks, both coming off the bat of Mason Holt. Solo shot in the top of the first, 2-run home run in the top of the fourth inning. Warhawks plate 3 runs and they tighten up the game a bit. 7-4 LSU still with the lead as Hayden Travinsky will start things off. Had a base hit and an RBI back in the first inning when LSU crossed home plate on 6 occasions. New pitcher on the mound for the Warhawks. It'll be Jackie Robinson, a left-hander, facing off against the right-handed hitting Travinsky. The first delivery. There's a strike just above the belt, and it's 0-1.
Yeah, one of the better ERAs on the staff. Robinson enters with a 3 ERA. This is his 5th appearance. He's worked 3 innings, 4 hits, 1 run allowed. He has 4 walks and only 1 strikeout.
Check swing and a foul ball back behind home plate, and Travinsky falls behind 0-2. Tigers tonight, 7 runs on 6 hits, 1 error. They've left 1 man on base for ULM. 4 runs, 5 hits, 1 error, 4 men left on. The 0-2 to Travinsky. The fastball from Robinson and a swing and a miss.
Whoa.
Comes in, strikes out the first batter. 1 away here in the bottom of the fourth. To the top of the order we go. Cade Doty, the Tigers shortstop. Tonight with a base hit, came around to score. One of those six runs in the first. Popped up down the line to Artsberger. Last time up in his second at bat of the first inning. He'll stand in, face Robinson for the first time, and the left-hander fires off speed but way upstairs, 1-0.
Doty's up to 358 on the season. Six home runs and 29 RBIs.
The 1-0 pitch. The heater misses outside, make it 2-0. Infield for the Warhawks playing straight up, as is the outfield. 2-0, another fastball, and it's fouled off by Doty. Another Rotolo's foul ball moves the count. Two balls, one strike. And now the wind blowing all day and so far all night, this time right to left towards the scoreboard in left center. 2-1. Misses outside. Now a hitter's count for Doty, 3-1.
Cleared for takeoff.
3-1, swing and a foul ball into the screen above the first base dugout. Three balls, two strikes.
Big Riley Cooper down in the bullpen for the Tigers.
3-2 delivery and a big swing and again lifted foul down the first baseline. Artsberger giving chase and fading back. Does he hold on? He does. The wind carried it, looked like it was going to find the seats, but the wind blowing briskly right to left brought it right back to Artsberger, who nearly lost it as it came down, but he tumbles over and holds on for out number two. Good play by Artsberger, the Warhawk first baseman.
You know, we see so many teams with trouble down the third baseline, the third and first baseline, specifically at the end of the dugouts, which is also right where the overhang ends. So lots of wind coming around that corner.
Trey Morgan stands in with two down. First pitch from Robinson misses low off speed, 1-0. Morgan tonight flied out to right on a rocket shot to record an out in the first inning. Earned a walk, left stranded in the second. Here's a swing right up the middle. A comebacker comes off the body of Robinson and caroms right to Artsberger, the first baseman, who picks it up and steps on the bag and just beats Morgan, who was trying to dive and get there safely. So Robinson with the assist with the body took it right off the back. But it landed right where the Warhawks could make the play for out number three. So the Tigers are done. No runs, no hits, nobody on base. We move now to the top of the fifth inning. It's a 7-4 Fighting Tiger lead. Warhawks come to the plate next on the LSU Sports Radio Network. 7-4 our score. Top of the fifth inning here at the box on a Tuesday night. Tigers elect to go to the bullpen once again to start the top half of the fifth. Riley Cooper comes into the game for the Fighting Tigers. He'll be facing off against the 3, 4, and 5 hitters, Schultz, Cato, and Artsberger. 7-4. Crew making it interesting here in the middle innings.
Yeah, big Riley Cooper going to go in for the 11th time this year. That leads the team. He enters with a 4.76 ERA. He is 1-1. This is his 10th appearance out of the bullpen.
First delivery offered up to Schultz. Missing high, 1-0.
In 11 and a third, Cooper has allowed 15 hits, 11 runs, only 6 earned. He has 3 walks and 8 strikeouts.
1-0 pitch and going to be touched and sent down foul the left field way. 1-1. Schultz tonight had a base hit in the first, left stranded. Strikeout victim last time in the third. And the Tigers got up big after Monroe took a 1-0 lead. It was 6-1 after one inning, 7-1 after three. Cooper misses at the knees to make it 2-1. The Warhawks able to bunt in a run and then a 2-run homer to score 3 in the top of the fourth, and it's a 7-4 LSU lead.
ULM has a right-hander warming up.
2-1 from Cooper. There's a strike. Even it up 2-2.
That's Nicholas Judice. And I kind of wonder, Chris, if the lefty will be able to get back out on the mound after taking that line drive in the back.
Here's a little slow bouncer to short. Took a high hop, but Doty fields it. Throws to Morgan in time. Nice play. On the 6-3 ground out, records out number one to start the top of the fifth inning.
At the plate for the Warhawks, designated hitter.
The way that Judice is moving down there makes me think that he will enter the game next. Again, the inning ended with a line drive off the back of Jackie Robinson, the left-handed pitcher on the mound for the Warhawks. It ricocheted over to first base for the final out.
Off-speed delivery, a called strike. Landon Cato out of Birmingham, Alabama. Cato tonight flied out to left and was a strikeout victim in the third. The 0-1, swing and a miss. A fastball. Down low in the zone, 0-2. Cooper, the 0-2 pitch, missing high upstairs, 1-2. The pitch hit the center field, going to drop down in front of Dylan Cruz. That'll be the 6th hit of the night for the Warhawks, and a 1-out single by Landon Cato, his first hit of the night. 18th hit on the year.
Now batting first baseman, Michelle Artsberger.
Now Artsberger. Left-handed batter will stand in tonight. Artsberger, back-to-back strikeouts, first and in the third.
Yeah, Tigers have combined for 6 strikeouts tonight.
Cooper fires, misses outside, 1-0. Cato at first base, one of 2 in the lineup tonight without a stolen base or an attempt. Cooper's 1-0. Fouled off the end of the bat. Slow bouncer behind the plate, and it's 1-1. Cooper working from the stretch. We'll look over to first. Now we'll toss over to Morgan. Cato again back safely. And you got to wonder if Robinson, for two reasons. One, he came running off the field after taking that shot in the back. There's one, a fly ball into shallow left. And Doty sails back, and the shortstop has it. for out number two. Whether it's precautionary on Robinson or he actually, once he made it to the dugout, realized he was maybe in more pain than initially shown. But
dude, there's no way that didn't hurt. That ball hit him directly between the numbers in the middle of the back. And it had some Tabasco sauce on it, a little extra juice.
Cooper again going to toss over. Cato stands back on the bag. Bring up Carson Jones again, who was inserted into the lineup at shortstop for the starter, Colby DeVille. He'll bat for the second time. First, Cooper again will toss over to first base. Jones flat out to Dylan Cruz in center field. Two gone, one man on. Tigers leading 7-4. Cooper to the plate, swing and a miss. Dialed it back up in the zone. Jones couldn't stay away, and it's 0-1. One of the reasons Coach Jason Kelly high on Riley Cooper is his change of pace. The fastball, the breaking ball, off-speed stuff. When things are going his way, he can keep batters off balance.
Yeah, he's got two that he can throw in the strike zone, an overhand curveball and a changeup.
Here's the 0-1. Just missed the outside corner. One ball, one strike.
And don't sleep on his fastball. We've seen it run up there at 93 miles an hour this year. He usually sits around 89 to 91, I would say. Be a fair range.
Yep. Cato again will take a lead off of first. Here's the 1-1 pitch. Missing outside to the right-handed hitter. It's now 2-1.
You know, these days, right-handers that throw 90 are a dime a dozen. Back when I was playing ball, that was kind of the benchmark. Nowadays, it's a little different. But with left-handers still, if they're able to hit 90 miles an hour, there's a place for him to play in college baseball somewhere.
Another throw over to first. 2-1 the count to Carson Jones. Cooper fires in the air, swung on to right field. Going back to Giacomo. Now he'll come in a few steps, put a glove on it for out number three. So the Warhawks, no runs, one hit. They leave that one man on. We go to the bottom of the fifth. LSU leading ULM 7-4 here on the LSU Sports Radio Network. Fans, visit your local Kubota dealer and see why Kubota is the number one rated reliability under 100 horsepower tractor in the U.S. of A. Just visit LSUKubotaDealers.com for your nearest Kubota dealer and test drive a Kubota today. It's a 7-4 ball game here on this Tuesday evening. LSU leading by 3 runs as we head to the bottom of the 5th inning. And Doug Thompson, new pitcher coming on for the Warhawks. And after LSU exploded for 6 runs in the bottom of the 1st, this ULM bullpen, kind of tip your cap, just 1 run. A couple of zeros on the scoreboard since that big explosion in the 1st frame.
Yeah, and I think ULM just brought their basketball team into pitch tonight. Nicky Judy's a right-hander, stands in there at 6'8", 230 pounds. He's at a Catholic High right here in Baton Rouge.
Dylan Cruz will lead things off for LSU. First delivery and a strike at the belt. Dylan almost unleashed, but the off-speed pitch he held back. It's 0-1.
Seventh time out for Judy's. He's worked 12 and two-thirds innings so far this year. 11 hits allowed. 12 runs, only 7 earned. He has 5 walks and 13 strikeouts.
Big swing by Cruz, lifted in the air, down the line in right field. Coming over and coming out is going to be the second baseman, Washburn, and he will make the play for out number 1. That time you had Washburn, Artsberger, and Henry all converging. But the Warhawks second baseman makes the play. And we'll see Jacob Berry step in. Jacob with a base hit and an RBI in that first inning, hit into a double play. Ground ball down the first baseline, handled by Artsberger. Through to second to get Morgan back in the second inning. Time called. Jay Johnson brings over Jacob Berry. He and Jordan Thompson will talk with the head coach on the on-deck circle here. Tigers again, 7 runs, 6 hits. 6 runs in the bottom of the 1st. They added 1 more in the bottom of the 3rd. Scoreless in the 2nd and 4th inning. Warhawks led 1-0 after Mason Holt had a solo home run to start the game. They'd add 3 more in the top of the 4th, including a 2-run homer from Holt. So Barry steps in from the left side. Judy's fires, and it misses at the letters, ball 1. The 1-0 pitch. Off speed and a strike to even it up 1-1.
Third pitcher of the night for ULM in the first 5 innings, over 6'6".
Here's the 1-1 pitch. Berry swings and fouls it back out of play. 1-2. Another right-hander loosening for the Warhawks down in the left field bullpen. One and two the count. Judy's with the pitch. Berry swings again, fouls it back. Still 1-2.
Guess how tall the right-hander is in the bullpen.
I'll take a guess, say 6'6".
6'6". He's got to be the tallest pitching staff in the country.
What do I win? Here's the 1-2 to Berry, way outside, missing. 2 balls, 2 strikes.
Seriously, I don't know that LSU has had 3 pitchers over 6'6" in the last decade. I mean, Beck was up there. I'm trying to think about it.
2-2 in on the hands and a foul and a swing back to the backstop.
Well, Gervais kind of makes up for it. 6'11". That makes up for it.
Berry fighting here at the plate with a 2-2 count. Right-hander Judice comes set. And the pitch, and a swing and a miss. Fastball up and a little out, and Berry down on strikes. Judice records his first strikeout in relief, and there's 2 gone. In the bottom of the 5th inning, we'll see Jordan Thompson. Thompson tonight 0-for-1. Didn't earn a walk, get aboard in the first, came around to score, grounded out to the second baseman Washburn in the third inning.
Thank goodness for that sixth inning first.
Thompson readies the bat. The pitch to the plate. There's a strike at the letters. Fastball at 88, and it's 0-1. Auburn coming to town this weekend, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. The 0-1 pitch off the end of the bat, a mile high into the air to center field. Holt coming in, now moving to his left. He settles under it for out number three. The Warhawks send the Tigers back to the dugout. Three up, three down. We head to the top of the sixth inning. Still 7-4 LSU leads. Back after this on the LSU Sports Radio Network. Top of the sixth inning, LSU leading Louisiana Monroe 7-4 here in Baton Rouge. Riley Cooper begins his second inning of work for the Tigers. First delivery, the breaking ball over for a strike. To Washburn, the second baseman. And it's 0-1. Washburn tonight, a strikeout and a base hit, did come around to score on that two-run home run, or rather on the bunt laid down. One of three runs scored in the top of the fourth. Here's a swing and a miss, and it's 0-2. Washburn on the year, now batting .235 as Cooper sends the fastball, rides in high. One ball, two strikes. One-two pitch, little soft liner towards shortstop, going back is Berry, and he will make the play as Doty slides behind him to avoid a collision. That one just off the bat, came down quickly. Berry never took his eyes off of it. Doty was coming over, and again, luckily they miss each other as Doty literally takes to a knee and slides behind Berry. Nicely choreographed by the third baseman and shortstop to record out number one. That'll bring up Trace Henry to the plate. The first pitch to the right-hander is sent back into the screen. Another Rotolo's foul ball, and it's 0-1. Cooper with the wind. Left-hander fires off speed. Misses low and inside. One ball and one strike. I mentioned LSU at home against Auburn this weekend. For ULM, they will head out to Arlington, Texas to take on UT Arlington in a three-game set in Sun Belt action. 2-1 as that one misses outside. 2-1 delivery, lifted foul and out of play down the right field line. Cooper offering up the fastball at 91. It's two balls, two strikes.
That's a good inning for Cooper to get through two innings of work. It'll probably be all we'll see because, again, they want to have him fresh for this weekend.
2-2 pitch. Just fighting it off as Henry fouls it right side out of play.
It's a good inning, I should say, if he gets 7, 8, 9 in the order. He doesn't want to face Holt if he doesn't have to.
2-2 pitch, fastball. Again, fouled off and out of play right side. Count remains two balls, two strikes. With one out, the 2-2 pitch. And again, Cooper delivers a 93-mile-an-hour heater, and it's fouled off the bat of Henry. Cooper looks into Travinsky. Looking for the out pitch, the 2-2. Called strike three. Got the fastball on the inside corner just above the knees. Nothing Henry could do with that one. And Cooper records the strikeout, his first in relief. That strikeout brought to you by Super One Foods. Great quality at super low prices. Nicely done by Cooper, and that will bring Matthew Lee. Lee laid down the sacrifice RBI bunt there in the fourth inning to get that first run of the fourth. And there's a swing and a miss. It's Cooper again delivers the heater at 91. It's 0-1. Lee still looking for his first hit of the season. He's earned a walk back in the second. The 0-1 missing low. One ball, one strike.
Yeah, he's only making that second start. He's out of Baton Rouge Catholic High, another Catholic High guy.
1-1, swing and a miss. Fastball in on the hands, and it's one ball, two strikes. Cooper looks like this will be his last inning of work.
I'm sure.
Tigers have action again in the right field bullpen as the 1-2 fouled off by Lee to stay alive.
Yeah, that's Eric Raiselman starting to toss down in the right field bullpen.
As Doug mentioned, Lee, a three-year letter winner at Catholic High School. The 1-2, looking for the outside corner and at the letters, just misses by Cooper. It's two balls, two strikes. With two outs, the 2-2. Looking for the inside corner and just misses with the fastball. Now a full count, 3-2.
Yeah, he thought he had both of those.
Lee digs in, two outs, and a 3-2 count. Cooper with the windup, payoff pitch.
See ya.
Called strike three on the inside corner. Lee started running down the first base line, but he stops after five steps as Cooper records the strikeout, two of which come for the reliever here in the top of the sixth inning. Another strikeout brought to you by Super One Foods, great quality at super low prices. Warhawks finished here in the top of the sixth. No runs, no hits, nobody on base. We move to the bottom of the sixth. LSU leading by 3 runs, 7-4 on the LSU Sports Radio Network. Bottom of the sixth inning, LSU holding on to a 7-4 lead. They led 7-1 after three. Warhawks able to plate three runs in the top of the fourth after a solo home run had ULM leading early in the top of the first inning. Both teams with six hits. The Tigers have been silent the last two innings. In fact, three of the last four, they've been held scoreless after putting six on the board in the bottom of the first inning. New pitcher on the mound once again for the Warhawks, Lucas Wepp. Senior out of Georgetown, Ontario, Canada. 6'5", 192 pounds. Braden Joubert will lead it off. Joubert tonight, 1-for-2, at a double with three RBI in that first inning. Webb fires and a swing and a miss. 94 on the delivery for the right-hander to make it 0-1. So a little velo there from Webb, who checks in. Now the 0-1. This is low and inside. One ball, one strike.
Yeah, this will be the ninth time out for Webb. Enters the game with a 3.46 ERA. He's 1-2. He's worked 13 innings, allowed 16 hits, 10 runs, 5 earned. He has 9 walks and 16 strikeouts. So there's something in there.
Joubert awaits. Wepp with the 1-1. In on the hands, misses for ball two. 95 registering on the gun.
Thought there might be something out there with him. 16 strikeouts again. It's not too shabby.
Two-one delivery. Again, another heater, but inside at the belt. And it's three balls, one strike. Joubert, by the way, again, as we mentioned, coming off a red-hot weekend. Again, added three more runs batted in tonight in that first inning on the base-clearing double. Average up to 317. 3-1 the count. The Canadian wept. The 3-1. High and deep to right center field. He caught all of that one. It's out of here. Joubert with his eighth round tripper of the season. And the Tigers get back to their scoring ways here in the bottom of the sixth. That'll make it 8-4 LSU.
415 feet. Came off the bat at 102 miles an hour. Partner, that was a no doubter. What do you say that hit about a third of the way up on the Planet Fitness scoreboard on right center?
Yeah.
Here's the replay. Let me check that. No, it
just missed the
it.
Corner. Missed the bottom corner.
That was smashed.
Well, I guess that's how you handle a 93, 95 mile an hour pitcher. You send it right back at 102 over the fence. Gavin Dugas now will stand in. Dugas, 2-for-2 tonight. First delivery, off speed, missing low, 1-0. Dugas with a double and an RBI in the first. And had the solo home run blasted down the left field line back in the third. The lone run for the Tigers in that third frame. This one misses high. Two balls, no strikes.
Yeah, if it's coming in there at 95 and you catch it on the barrel, there's a great chance that it's going to exit at over 100.
Time called. Two guys will step out. Gavin, by the way, Doug's called for it all year. Again, it would be great to have another sensational season that he had a year ago, but has had the average up now to 311. There's a strike on the inside corner, a fastball at 94 to make it 2-1. Starting to get on track. Again, four doubles on the year, three home runs. He had one of each tonight. The 2-1, big swing, but comes up empty, 2-2. Nobody out, bottom of the sixth. Joubert with a leadoff bomb to right center. Here's the 2-2 from Wepp. Breaking ball misses outside, and a good eye by Dugas. Leaned in, loaded the bat, but stays away. It's a full count, 3-2. Payoff delivery from Wepf. Misses outside. Tried to paint that corner. And that will walk. Two guys down to first base. So the Tigers with a man aboard. We'll see Giovanni DiGiacomo looking for his first hit of the night. He's 0 for 2.
You know, Chris, we've been talking about the RBIs from Joe Bear. He had 9 at Florida. And I just looked back. Those 9 came Saturday and Sunday. So now Joe Bear has 13 RBIs in the last 2.5 games.
Dugas will settle into a leadoff of first. Wepf comes to the plate. DiGiacomo showing bunt. Gets away from the catcher, Matthew Lee. Easily into second goes Dugas, but I think it also hit DiGiacomo. He came up gimpy. May have caught him in the lower leg, maybe the top of the foot. And eventually the home plate umpire, Jordan Alvarado, grants him first base. So he will go down, runners first and second. And that's going to bring a meeting out on the mound here. Again by the pitching coach for the Warhawks, Colton Childress, in his first year. Was that the head coach?
Yep, that's actually Federico there, number 13. There is a left-hander down in the bullpen. At the moment, it looks like they're just going to talk it over. But Federico could also just be giving him a little extra time.
The hard-throwing right-hander's giving up the solo home run. Now facing two men on. Travinsky scheduled to come to the plate here as head coach Federico continues to talk with his battery, Matthew Lee and Lucas Wepf. They are just talking it over. Coach Federico headed back to the third base dugout.
Tough nine-hole hitter.
Travinsky came in late in game one, had a solo home run against the Gators late in game one to make it a 7-2 final. Then got his second home run on Sunday. He'll stand in, runners first and second, still nobody out. He'll show bunt and lay it down the third base side. Charging in is Schultz, the throw to first, his only play. And Travinsky gets a hand, does his job, advances the runners second to third on the sack bunt, one away.
I wonder how many times Hayden Travinsky has sacrificed bunt in his career.
I'd say not a whole lot in his prep days up in Shreveport.
Nice bunt from the big guy there.
Really was. And now what could turn into possibly a extended inning here. Razelman appeared to be ready to go, and he's still not throwing again, but he's going to stay out there and up just in case this inning does get extended. He is already prepared to come in for the top of the seventh against the Warhawks. Runners second and third here for the Tigers. Dugas at third, DiGiacomo at second. Kay Doty at the plate. The breaking ball's in the dirt, plated up by Lee, who keeps it in front of him. It's 1-0. Doty batting 365. 1-for-3 in that leadoff spot tonight. Wepf with the pitch. Swing and a miss on a pitch low and inside. It's 1-1. Tiger fans, remember, you can show off your team spirit at the game or even while you're at home. Just visit Cox.com/Tigers. You can take a selfie with your favorite Tiger. Cox, we're LSU fans 24/7. Tigers threatening again, already one run in the sixth as this one launched high in the air to right field. Settling back is Henry, shy of the track but deep enough. He'll come up with the catch. Runners will both tag up and advance. Coming in to score will be Dugas, and a sac fly RBI off the bat of Kate Doty. We'll now make it 9-4 LSU. DiGiacomo headed on into third base, so with two outs, another potential run just 90 feet away, and Trey Morgan will have the honors as he stands in.
First baseman, Trent Morgan.
Morgan tonight, 0 for 2. Pitch and a big swing. Got a piece, sends it to the backstop, 0-1. Morgan, a fly out and a ground out, bookending a walk back in the second inning. Webb was the 0-1. This one a sharply hit one hopper to the shortstop. Coming up with it is Jones, throws across the diamond in time for out number three. But the Tigers add to their lead. Two runs on one hit, including a solo home run here in the bottom of the sixth inning. They take a 9-4 lead as we head to the seventh. Warhawks come to the plate here on the LSU Sports Radio Network. Tigers add to their lead. They're in the bottom of the sixth inning, 9-4. Back up by five runs. We hit the top of the seventh inning. Eric Raiselman will come in to pitch for the Tigers. He will face the top of the order. Mason Holt to lead it off. Holt tonight, well, he's been a bright spot for the Warhawks. A couple of home runs, a solo shot in the first, and a two-run blast in the fourth inning.
Raiselman will make his 11th appearance, that is tied for the team lead with Riley Cooper. Enters the game with a 2.08 ERA, 1-1 with a save. And in 13 innings of work, 9 hits allowed, 4 runs, 3 earned. He had 7 walks and 22 strikeouts.
Fans finding health care shouldn't require extra innings. That's why Our Lady of the Lake makes it convenient to fit care into your busy schedule. Learn more at OLOLRMC.com/video visits. Proud to be the official healthcare provider of LSU Athletics. So Raiselman will toe the rubber. Holt, as we mentioned, done some damage tonight at the plate. 1, 2, and 3 hitters due up in the top of the seventh frame as Raiselman fires, and the fastball a little high. 96 on the first offering, and it's 1-0. Kicks and fires the 1-0 pitch. Another fastball. This one a strike at 95, and it's 1-1.
Looks a little more firm than the other 95s we've seen tonight, for whatever reason.
Holt awaits, and the 1-1 pitch, swing and fouled out of play. 97 on that fastball. 96, 95, and now 97.
A 98 for a straight would be needed here.
1-2 the count to Holt. Raisman trying to retire the leadoff hitter in the one spot for the just the second time, and he does so there. How about 98 outside, and Holt chased it, swing and a miss. Impressive young man. Eric Raisman records his first punch out. A big one there. Brought to you by Super One Foods. Great quality at super low prices. One away in the top of the seventh.
Giddy up. Ooh. 98. That I think that's the top of the year so far. I don't remember a 98. I do remember a couple 97s, but that's a whole new number.
Cupid, a left-hander, to face the right-handed Raisman now with one out. First pitch, right down the middle.
98, by the way.
0-1 the count.
We learned that when you don't see the pitch speed and back-to-back pitches here at the box, that means that it was a duplicate number. So back-to-back 98-mile-an-hour fastballs.
The 0-1 pitch. Bell tie. Say missed a tad. It's 1-1.
How much money would it take you?
To stand in?
Yep.
Take a little bit of a kitty, there's no doubt. I'd have no problem watching you stand in. That would be fun.
Oh, man.
One ball, one strike. The pitch right down the middle. 97, no offering from Cupid. It's 1-2.
I'd stand in for no amount of money if I was positive that he wouldn't hit me.
One ball, two strikes with one down in the top of the seventh. Setting up outside, Travinsky in the 1-2.
99.
Just missed, and it registers 99 on the radar gun. He was going for that outside corner and just missed. Not by much. It's 2-2.
You can hear the buzz of the crowd after that one.
Everybody's sitting up in their
Come
seats
on,
now.
If you got 99, one more little grunt, a little extra grunt gets you to three digits. Let's see it.
One out and a 2-2 count. Cupid awaits from the left side. Raisman fires and a high fastball, swing and a miss. 98, he dials it back and records a second strikeout here in the top of the seventh inning. Another strikeout for Raisman, brought to you by Super One Foods. Great quality at super low prices.
And there's just no way to hit that pitch when it's above your hands. And that pitch was up in the strike zone a little bit. Cupid has 0% chance.
So now Grant Schultz will try his hand. The number three hitter in the lineups, 1-for-3 tonight. Had that base hit back in the first. First pitch, ground ball towards second. Thompson diving, knocks it down as he tries to rise and throw. He lost the handle. And Schultz will arrive safely here in the top of the seventh inning.
Interesting. Had to move a little bit to his left. Had to slide to get in front of the ball, but if not awarded that a hit or an error yet.
Schultz able to extend the inning here with two outs. Brings Cato to the plate. Raisman looks over his shoulder to the runner, now to the plate. His fastball misses outside, 1-0.
What's Chris Blair give that one? Hit or an error? The pitcher in me says error.
Yeah, I say error.
But he did have to go.
I mean, it wasn't an easy play, don't get me
wrong. No, it wasn't, but he could have made it. Taking their time giving that one.
The 1-0 swung on and fouled out of play to even the count to Cato, 1-1. Yeah, all eyes up there.
Still no indication.
Appears the deliberations continue. One ball, one strike, two outs, runner at first. 9-4 LSU leads. Raisman, the 1-1. Did he go around? They'll appeal down to first, and Zachary Edgen says yes, and it's one ball, two strikes. Is that 97-mile-an-hour heater down in the zone? Cato couldn't stay away. One ball, two strikes, and two outs. Runner at first takes their lead. Razelman looks in. The pitch. Missed high with a 98-mile-an-hour fastball. It's 2-2.
Still, no hit or error awarded to the last play.
Razelman again from the stretch. Two balls, two strikes. Cato at the plate, runner on and two outs. The pitch down the line. One hopper right at Morgan at first. He'll take it on the short hop, take a step, and record out number three. Warhawks are done. Again, they leave one man on. They come away with no runs. We now take a time to stretch it out at the box on a Tuesday night. Seventh inning stretch, the Tigers leading 9-4. LSU will send to the plate Cruz, Barry, and Thompson when we come back on the LSU Sports Radio Network. Bottom of the seventh, LSU comes to the plate. They lead ULM here in this Tuesday midweek game, 9-4. Another new pitcher onto the mound for the Warhawks. Adam Tubbs will take over for Coach Federico. He'll be the seventh pitcher of the night.
Yeah, he's not really that tall. 5'10" is Tubbs, 185 pounds. Again, out of Sterlington, Louisiana, Sterlington High School. This year, Tubbs, making his sixth appearance, has a 3 ERA. He's worked three innings, allowed two hits, one earned run. He has two walks and four strikeouts.
Dylan Cruz to lead it off for LSU. The left-hander delivers a breaking ball, and it just misses outside, 1-0. Very close to a 12-6 action on that breaking pitch. We'll see what he offers here as Tubbs fires, and again, breaking ball misses low. It's now 2-0. Cruz tonight, 0-for-3 at the plate. Got aboard on an error in the first, came around to score. The 2-0, swing and a miss on the off-speed pitch that again dropped low and away. It's 2-1. Another breaking ball, but a foul ball bouncer down the third baseline will even the count after another Rotolo's foul ball. While we have a moment, let's pause 10 seconds. Station identification on this, the LSU Sports Radio Network. Back inside the Caesar Sportsbook broadcast booth, a 2-2 pitch now to Dylan Cruz. Misses high. Fills the count 3-2. Hunter McCann, Straw stirring the drink back in the Capital One studios tonight. Doug Thompson, Chris Blair with you here inside the booth with the Tigers leading 9-4. This pitch on the full count misses way outside. Got loose from Tubbs, and that will send Cruz down. The base on balls. By the way, going back there to the top of the seventh inning, that ground ball to Jordan Thompson eventually ruled a hit for the Warhawks. Seventh hit of the ball game. For those who are still hanging on to find out. We'll see Jacob Berry stand in. Jacob with a base hit and an RBI in the first, hit into a double play in the second, and was a strikeout victim last time in the fifth. Tubbs delivers, it's at the ankles, it dances out of the way, and it's 1-0.
Yeah, Barry's down to 343 with no hits, or excuse me, one hit tonight. Been sitting on eight home runs for about a week.
Tubbs now with a slow throw over to first. Almost got away from Artsberger, who had to cross through Cruz trying to get to the bag just to get his glove on.
Comes the rally train.
904 special on this, or rather 804 special on this Tuesday. Pitch from Tubbs misses high. It's now 2-0 to Berry. Stand corrected, 903. That's what happens when you go to the East Coast and then come back to the Central Time Zone.
You've been all over the place lately.
Checks the runner, now the pitch. Breaking ball there for a strike at the knees, 2-1.
Get to stay home this weekend, though. It's not a bad thing.
Yeah, absolutely.
And a Thursday, Friday, Saturday series, a little bit different. So you'll have a Sunday off. I don't know what you're going to do with that.
Oh, though, something will come up. The 2-1.
That was behind it.
Throws behind Barry, caught a piece of him. And that'll put runners first and second here with nobody out. So not the start Coach Federico wanted in his reliever Tubbs. So here's a question for everybody. Travel from the Central Time Zone. Let's say pick a place. Go Pacific, go Mountain, go East.
Okay.
When you arrive, if you're one who wears a watch that's not digital, if you go old school automatic watch like I do.
Yeah.
Do you change it to the time zone you're in, or do you leave it in your existing Central Time Zone?
Chris, when we lose an hour, gain an hour, sometimes it takes me 4 months to change my watch back. Or four. So no. Do not do it on just a trip out to the East Coast.
Well, see, that's where I typically stay on Central Time. And for some odd reason, this trip to Gainesville, I thought, you know what? We got two night games and an early morning start, 12 noon, which is not morning, I know, but for my body, it's 11 a.m. Central. So I decided to go ahead, change the watch to Eastern Time, and I just noticed just moments ago, haven't changed
that. That's why I don't do it. I just can't.
Yeah, it's a good rule to live by.
Yeah.
Stay on your own time
zone.
That's it. Because you got your phone. And
then you got to wind, and sometimes they don't go backwards, and you can't reverse. It's just not worth it.
Don't even get me started about the day of the month.
Look, I'm so lazy, I don't even change the digital clock on my truck when the time changes.
Runners first and second. Jordan Thompson stands in, and ground ball just left of third base. Tiger fans groaning a little bit. Looked like it went right over the bag, but right there on the line was Colby Vedrine. And the umpire says it was foul. So 0-1 the count to Thompson, who tonight got a walk in the first, came around to score, a ground out in the third, and flied out to center to Mason Holt in the fifth inning. He's got Cruz at second, Jacob Berry hit by a pitch down at first, so Tubbs gave up the walk, then the hit batter. 0-1 sails outside. One ball, one strike. Again, what's our hit by pitch count now?
Let's see. 61 plus 3 is 64. Five away from last year's total, and about third of the way. Maybe a little more than a third of the way.
Runners take their lead. The pitch sails upstairs. 2-1 the count now to Thompson.
I've got my eye on the national mark. 152. It's probably the only national record Delaware State has, so it'll be a tough year for them if they fall to number two there, but I think we've got a chance.
Two balls, one strike to Thompson. Pitch from Tubbs. Foul back and out of play off the bat.
Watch
Jordan.
Out.
King back down on the screen. Jordan was taking a trip around the circle, and ball came right back at him, but luckily missed by several feet. 2-2 the count. Fans, turn your dreams into reality with Toyota's Ready, Set, Go sales event. Just visit your local Toyota dealer at toyota.com today. This pitch swung back into the screen on a foul ball. Keeps the count 2-2. Tigers with 6 runs in the bottom of the first. They added a solo home run in the third. And 2 runs in the bottom of the sixth inning. 2-2 to Thompson's going to hit him. So add another on the pile, and that'll load the bases here with nobody out in the bottom of the seventh inning. Things getting awfully tough for Tubbs. The Tigers easily winning the free base war tonight in this midweek affair. That's the third free pass. 1 walk, 2 hit batters. No, load them all up.
That's 3 hit batters. Boy, that's the 4th hit batsman tonight.
I'm in this inning.
Oh,
Cruz walked.
This inning.
Yeah, I just keep it to innings at this point. We'll get to the total at the end of the game.
We're around 7 right now. If you include the error, that's 8. I assume that's part of the turnovers, right? The errors?
Yes. There's a strike on the inside corner to Joubert, who, again, seeing the ball extremely well. Average up to 325 tonight. A double that brought in 3 runs in the first. Had a solo home run in the sixth inning. His 8th homer of the year. Got the bases loaded here. The 0-1. Nice breaking ball from Tubbs, and I guess somehow just caught the inside corner. 1-1. Cruz at third, Barry at second, Thompson at first base. 1-1 to Joubert. Outside, comes off the top of the mid of Lee. Cruz on his way home. There'll be no throw, and the Tigers making an even 10-4. Little cross up there?
I think so. I'd like to see it again on the monitor to be sure.
Adam Tubbs having all kinds of trouble here in this inning. Coming in to pitch for the Warhawks. 2 walks, a hit batter, now possibly a wild pitch. We'll see what the ruling is.
I think that's a pass ball. I think the catcher just took his eye off of it, had it in the glove. It just bounced out.
Strike on the inside corner with a breaking ball now from Tubbs to make it 2-2 to Joubert.
Another couple RBIs out there for Joubert. He's been hungry for those lately. Already 4 tonight.
This one high and deep to right center field. Going back at the wall. It is out of here. Hey now, Braden Joubert. 3 more ribbies tonight. Give him 7. 16 in the last 2.5 games. And the Tigers open it up. 13-4, they lead.
16 in the last 2.5 games. Just to put that in perspective, DiGiacomo has 13 this season, Dugas 16, and Thompson 11. Another pitcher is going to come in now. Wow.
So the Warhawks will make a pitching change, powered by Sunshine, your hometown John Deere dealer in Louisiana. Tigers already plated 4 runs, highlighted by a 3-run homer to right center for Braden Joubert, number 9 on the year. Still nobody out. We'll tell you about the new ULM pitcher when we come back on the LSU Sports Radio Network.
by way of Georgetown, came from UT San Antonio. He has one appearance on the year. This is number two. He's worked an inning, allowed three runs. They were all earned. He had five walks in that one opportunity. So he's looking to try to get some strikes over the plate, earn some more time.
Won't be easy. Gavin Dugas coming up. Double with an RBI in the first. He added to his home run total with a shot back in the third inning. Solo home run and a walk in the sixth inning. Dugas stands in. Nobody out. Here in the bottom of the seventh inning. Engelman, the right-hander, working from the stretch to get things started. Now we'll bring it to the plate. And it misses low. Ball one. 1-0. Tigers, six runs in the bottom of the first. They added a run in the bottom of the third. Two runs in the bottom of the sixth, and now four here in the seventh. Breaking ball catches the inside corner at 69, and it's 1-1.
Yeah, these boys playing some gorilla ball tonight. Three home runs. Dugas with one. Joe Bear with two. Couple doubles.
Engelman, the 1-1. There's a strike at the knees. Dugas will back up out of the box for a moment. One ball, two strikes.
Only eight hit for the Tigers, 13 runs. That's all those free passes you were talking about earlier.
Tigers with eight home runs over the weekend. And as Doug mentioned, three tonight. The 1-2. In the air to center field, Mason Holt moving over to his left will have it for out number one. So Dugas flies out to center. And we'll have a pinch hitter coming in. Pearson will pick up the bat. He'll come to the plate.
Yeah, six of the runs tonight have come on walks and hit batsmen. It's not that LSU hasn't earned them, but the Warhawks have certainly made it easy with all the free passes.
So Josh Pearson will get a chance to hit in for Giovanni DiGiacomo. Pearson with his 14th at bat of the year. First pitch, comebacker going to be snagged by Engelman. Underhand toss to first, and there's two gone. That'll bring Travinsky, the catcher, to the plate. Hayden tonight, base hit with an RBI in the first, strikeout victim in the fourth, and laid down a perfect sack bunt in the sixth inning to advance runners second and third. And again, we've talked about the home runs tonight. We've talked about a few extra base hits, but I think you put it best. That was a beautiful bunt by Travinsky.
And maybe one of the only of his career.
First pitch from Engelman down in the dirt, 1-0.
We come back next inning. I'll catch you up on some scores. There's 13 games around the SEC tonight.
One ball, no strikes to Travinsky. Again, missing outside and low. From Engelman, it's now two balls, no strikes. The Tigers certainly have heated up on the field tonight at the plate. Fans, whenever you're ready to cool it down, always count on Slow Melt Ice. Since 1997, check them out at slowmeltice.com. A 2-0 pitch from Engelman. On its way. Breaking pitch across for a strike. 2-1. One to Travinsky. Swung on and popped up into shallow right center field. Holt coming in. The center fielder gets there in time for out number three. So the Tigers are finished, but not before they add four runs to their lead. Highlighted by the home run once again from Joe Bear, his second of the night. It's now 13-4 LSU. ULM coming to the plate after this on the LSU Sports Radio Network. Top of the eighth inning coming your way from Alec Box Stadium on this Tuesday. LSU now leading 13-4. Warhawks come to the plate. Razelman continues on the mound for the Tigers, and the first pitch missing high to Artsberger, the first baseman.
Also for LSU now catching number 26, Tyler McManus.
Tyler McManus checks in behind the plate in place of Travinsky, who got the start tonight. Razelman with the 1-0. Big swing and a miss. But way behind the 94-mile-an-hour fastball. And it's one ball, one strike. Speaking of catchers, Travinsky and McManus holding things down for the injured Alex Milazzo. Coach Johnson last night letting us all know that Alex making his way back sooner than later. Although there's no rush to bring him back, make sure he is fully healthy. There's a swing and a miss on a 96-mile-an-hour heater, and it's 1-2. Alex was optimistic this weekend in Gainesville, made the trip. Was not on the travel roster, but did go with the team, and he felt like he might be able to get back at some point this weekend. Coach Johnson tampered that down last night, saying they did not want to rush him back. The 1-2 off the end of the bat, fouled back into the screen. But it's never a bad thing. Again, you don't want to see an injury. You don't want to lose an asset like Milazzo behind the plate, Doug Thompson. But, you know, early on in the year, if you have to have an injury where you know you've got a player coming back to get some depth and get some reps for your backup catchers, never a bad thing in a long college baseball season. Here's
absolutely
the 1-2.
Not.
Went around. High fastball. Artsberger couldn't stay away. Razelman records another strikeout. Throwing sheer fire out there on the mound. It'll be his third punch out of the night. Another strikeout brought to you by Super One Foods. Great quality at super low prices.
Now batting the shortstop, Carson Jones.
Carson Jones comes up to bat for the third time. Didn't get the start tonight. Colby DeVille made the start at short, but Jones inserted into the field and at the plate. Two flyouts tonight on his ledger. Razelman fires, high and inside, ball one. Ty Floyd warming down in the Tiger bullpen.
Yeah,
and Razelman probably going to go if nothing happens here. Two innings, and then we'll see Ty Floyd.
Unless he's just getting a little bullpen in, but
1-0. Another fastball. A little up in the zone and a swing and a miss by Jones. And it's 1-1.
When Razelman's pitching, the pitch speed should show every time on the scoreboard. Well, I feel like that's where everybody's eyes go as soon as the ball hits the glove.
There's the 1-1. Breaking ball just
speed.
Missed. 2-1.
I haven't seen him throw a bender in there in, I feel like, a few weeks. Did
Been
he throw
while.
Any at Florida?
Mm-mm.
All fastballs.
Yep.
It's not just any fastball, of course.
One out. Here's the 2-1. Another breaking ball. A bouncer down the third baseline. Charging in is Berry. The throw across the diamond is there for out number two. Nicely done by Berry at third base. Gets a hand from the Tiger faithful.
And how about that back-to-back curveballs from Razelman? I tell you, if he can figure that out and mix that in there with a couple hundred-mile-an-hour heaters, I really like the back end of this Tigers bullpen even more.
So with two down in the top of the eighth, we'll see Washburn, the second baseman. 1-for-3 tonight. Fastball in on the hands. New pinch hitter, Michael Cervantes, will come in for Washburn. So Cervantes swinging the bat for the first time tonight. First pitch was inside for ball one. Razelman kicks and fires the 1-0 pitch. Strike at the knees. One ball, one strike. Just one of your average, ordinary 92-mile-an-hour fastballs. Cervantes, by the way, batting for the 10th time this year. He's 1-for-9 on the season, or rather 3-for-9 on the seasons. Scored a run, drove in a run. The 1-1. There's a strike, 97. Speeds it back up, and it's one ball, two strikes. Two outs here in the top of the eighth. The Tigers up 13-4. Louisiana Monroe running out of outs here in Baton Rouge. 1-2 lifted in the air to right center field. Cruz was perfectly positioned. He'll come over to his left and settle under it for out number three. So the Warhawks go quietly. No runs, no hits, nobody on base. We go to the bottom of the eighth inning. 13-4, LSU leads. Tigers coming to the plate when we come back on the LSU Sports Radio Network.
Also for the Warhawks, now playing
13-4, LSU leads Louisiana Monroe. Bottom of the eighth inning coming your way. A couple of defensive changes to tell you about. Taking over in right field will be Cole Strombo, sophomore out of Mandeville, Louisiana. Also at second base, saw Cervantes come up and hit. Try to hit there in the top of the eighth inning. He takes over at second base. Connor Klein will take over on the mound. Another pitcher for the Warhawks.
Connor Klein making his sixth appearance of the year. Enters the game with 4 1/3 innings of work so far. 10 hits, 7 earned runs allowed. He has 3 walks and 1 strikeout. Klein is 6'1", 200 pounds, a redshirt senior out of Indiana State.
Also at third base, Chase DeJean takes over defensively. And the first pitch to the pinch hitter, Collier Cranford, going to hit him in the back. So another hit batter will send the leadoff man down to first base to start the bottom of the eighth inning.
Telling you, we're watching history.
Starting to get on board with him.
We're watching history. Another pitch hitter.
Another pinch hitter for the Tigers. Bat for Trey Morgan here. Lito will pick up the bat. Left-hander will stand in with Cranford at first base. The pitch from Klein misses low for ball one.
Yeah, Luke Lito, this is his fourth at bat of the year. He is still looking for his first hit.
Cranford with a short lead. Pitch comes into Lito, misses outside, make it 2-0. Trying to get you an update on scores around the SEC.
I will do that.
Here's the 2-0, misses high, and now a 3-0 count to Luke Lito.
Took me a while to figure out who wasn't playing tonight. It's one of my least favorite things to do. There's 12 games. It takes me usually about 15 minutes to figure out the two teams that aren't playing. But I got it. It's Tennessee. They're off tonight.
The 3-0 catches the inside corner to Leto, make it 3-1.
A couple games are close to wrapping up. There are multiple that have gone final. I'll start there. Georgia defeated Georgia Southern 7-2 earlier.
3-1 misses outside. Leto will take the walk. Now here in the bottom of the eighth, two free passes, hit batter and a walk. LSU overwhelmingly winning the free base war tonight in this matchup. That'll be our new phrase, thanks to Coach Jay Johnson.
The turnover battle?
Yeah, he likes calling it the free base war, so it's a little different like than it. Football and basketball. But you're exactly right. That's what it is.
So Josh Stevenson going to dig in there now for Dylan Cruz. Three pinch hitters in a row in the bottom of the eighth for the Tigers. Kentucky lost tonight in Lexington 6-3 to Eastern Kentucky.
Pitch misses high, and that'll be ball one to Stevenson. That will force Matthew Lee, the catcher, to go out and visit with Connor Klein. So the Colonels beat the Wildcats.
They did. Missouri winners 11-7 over Illinois and Columbia. Missouri now 14-7 on the year. Mississippi State went on the road to Memphis, got the win tonight. 10 runs on 6 hits for the Bulldogs, who are 16-10 after winning the national championship last season.
Stevenson back at the plate, the 1-0 pitch. Misses high for ball two, 2-0 offered up by Klein. Stevenson on the year, 2-for-9 at the plate. 2 runs scored, has driven in a run. Has made his way to base on 5 walks this year. Runners first and second, nobody out. Bottom of the eighth, 13-4, LSU leading. Klein looks at the runner at second, now the 2-0. Missed the outside corner, 3 balls, no strikes. By the way, Braden Joubert with those 2 home runs tonight. His first 415 feet at 102 miles an hour. Yeah. His second 401 feet over the right center field wall at 101 off the bat. Here's the 3-0 pitch. Outside, ball 4, and that's going to load the bases. So much like his colleague Adam Tubbs, Connor Klein comes in, offers up the free passes, loads up the bases, and nobody out for the Tigers. Here in the bottom of the eighth, and we'll see Drew Bianco pick up the bat. He'll come in to bat for Jacob Berry in the 4 spot.
Jay Johnson emptying the benches here, but you wouldn't know it because the bases are juiced with no outs. Vanderbilt won 7-1 over Lipscomb. The Commodores improved to 20-4 on the year. That one hits Bianco. Unbelievable.
That'll bring in a run, and that's going to bring out Coach Federico, and he gets 3 steps out of the dugout and makes the call. So that'll make it 14-4 LSU, and another pitching change for ULM. Powered by Sunshine, your hometown John Deere dealer in Louisiana. I'll tell you who the Warhawks send to the mound after this timeout. 14-4 LSU leads, nobody out in the bottom of the eighth. Bases remain loaded when we come back on the LSU Sports Radio Network. Wyatt Blaylock will take over for ULM here in the bottom of the eighth inning. They find themselves in more trouble. Bases loaded, already one run in with the bases loaded. Bianco took a pitch to the backside. He's down at first now, and Blaylock going to come in, try to find some outs.
10th pitcher of the night for ULM. Wyatt Blaylock is 6 foot, 190 pounds, out of Madison, Mississippi, went to Jones Community College. Blaylock this season has worked in 10 games, leads the staff by three outings. This is number 11. He has a 7.71 ERA at seven innings of work. He's allowed 10 hits and six earned runs. He has five walks and four strikeouts.
So the Tigers have three men on, Leto at third, Stevenson at second, Bianco at first base. As Jack Merrifield will pick up the bat, and he will come in to pinch it in the five spot. First delivery from Blaylock. Hit into the air to left center field, giving chase. Cupid coming over, should be deep enough. He'll make the catch, but coming in to score will be Leto. And that'll make it 15-4. So Merrifield with the sac fly RBI extends the lead. Runners remain first and second, first out of the inning.
I was thinking if Merrifield got on, we had to have some kind of a record with five consecutive pinch hitters reach base. But five consecutive productive at-bats for the bench here in the bottom of the eighth inning, but you can't take this guy out of the lineup. Not with base runners.
Braden Joubert's had a night. He's had a big couple of games. In fact, two and a half. First delivery from Blaylock misses low. Again, we were talking during the break. Five hit batters tonight, I believe, at last
check, right,
which is a total of 13 going back to Sunday's game three at Florida. Which one was more outstanding? 13 hit batters or 16 RBIs in almost the same time, two and a half games for Braden Joubert.
Which one's more unusual, right? I mean, Joubert's driven in more runs than three of the starters in the lineup in the whole season in the last two and a half games or so. We're kind of approaching three games now, we could say. But I don't know if that's as unusual as the 13 hit by pitches in the last two games. That's bizarre.
1-0 the count to Joubert. Again, high in the air to right field. This time the park may hold it as going back is Strombo. He will make the grab, but off the bat, you can hear the excitement here at the park. It's a long fly ball out. Out number two here in the bottom of the eighth inning. Runners stay put first and second. But again, now you've got Alex Milazzo picking up a bat. We just talked about him moments ago. He's going to get a chance to hit. You'll hear the crowd here at the box applauding his return to the diamond.
Yeah, I guess we'll get to see it behind the dish in the top of the ninth. That'll be nice. Maybe. Travinsky's still in the game.
McManus checked in that top of the eighth. But Milazzo will get a chance to swing here with runners first and second and two out. Blaylock checks the runners and fires. Strike at the letters. The fastball from Blaylock, and it's 0-1. Tigers have Stevenson at second. Bianco down at first base. Milazzo batting for the 21st time. Again, hampered by a knee injury. Been on the shelf for a while, working hard to get back out there for his team. The 0-1, a swing and a foul that bounces towards the backstop. And he falls behind 0-2. And Coach Johnson very careful with his words last night. Caller asked about the return of Milazzo behind the plate. And as we just discussed, he talked about not rushing him back, but he didn't talk about him swinging the bat. The 0-2 misses low. Good eye by Alex, and it's 1-2.
I'm going to call into that show one night. Disguise my voice, see if you pick up on it.
I can't wait to hear the disguised voice.
Think of a good question.
Two outs here in the bottom of the eighth. 15-4 LSU leading. Looking to pick up their 18th win of the year. Here's the 1-2 to Milazzo. Stayed away, and it just missed a little high and maybe outside. 2-2.
I think I could trick you on skip calling it.
Yeah, there's a good chance of that.
Especially maybe for, not for long. For
especially with the phone degradation, you know, it's not clear.
12, 15 seconds, I think I can get away with it before you go, wait a minute.
It's not high fidelity, but you might get us for a few moments. Here's the 2-2 in the air to right field. Again, Strombo settling back, now stepping up, and he'll squeeze it for out number three. So the Tigers finished in the bottom of the eighth, but they add to their lead. Two runs, zero hits. No errors committed by the Warhawks. We head to the top of the ninth. Last chance for ULM here in Baton Rouge. They trail 15-4 on the LSU Sports Radio Network. Tigers trailed going into the bottom of the first inning 1-0 on a Mason Holt solo home run to start the game. They got back on top quickly, scoring six in the bottom of the first, added one in the bottom of the third, two in the bottom of the sixth, four in the bottom of the seventh, and two more moments ago in the bottom of the eighth inning. They now lead big 15-4. We head to the top of the ninth inning. A couple of changes to tell you about after a...
More than a couple.
A bunch of pinch hitters by Coach Jay Johnson there in the bottom half of the eighth inning. Stevenson moves to right field. Drew Bianco takes over in center. Holt takes over at second base. Leto replaces Morgan at first. Merrifield at third. Cranford takes over at short. And Pearson in left field for the Tigers. McManus again checked in the top of the eighth inning behind the plate. And Ty Floyd going to take over on the mound here to try to close it up on a Tuesday night. His team with an 11-run lead. Strombo, who checked in right field, will bat for the first time. The left-handed hitter takes the first pitch, called strike from Floyd, and it's 0-1.
Ty Floyd making his second appearance out of the bullpen this year.
The 0-1 hit in the air to left field. Coming in, though, is going to be Pearson. Runs in, makes the play, one down, two to go for the Fighting Tigers.
Floyd enters with a 3-2 record, a 3.52 ERA. He's worked 23 innings, allowed 14 hits, 10 runs, only nine of those earned. 15 walks and 28 strikeouts. He leads the team and walks with those 15. And also, he is third in innings pitched with 23.
Chris Noble will pinch hit. Native of Shreveport, Louisiana, left-handed hitter. Floyd fires the first pitch, and the fastball misses high. It's 1-0. Another interesting thought from Coach Johnson's radio show last night, the season premiere, first time ever having Coach Johnson at TJ Ribs. Had a great time visiting with him as the 1-0 comes in. Called strike at the letters, makes it 1-1. He was called and asked about, with the success, again, LSU using minimum pitchers in that series win against Florida, did he like that starting rotation we saw last week with Money, Hilliard, and Sam Dutton getting his first SEC start? Here's the 1-1, and it's a swing and a miss, and Floyd gets ahead 1-2. His answer was, you will definitely see Blake Money. You will definitely see Mikhail Hilliard. And I'm really happy with the way it worked out last weekend. So draw your own conclusion going into the Auburn series.
It might go back to Taylor and maybe handing it to Dutton. But
here's the 1-2, swing and a miss. Floyd records the strikeout. Two down, one to go here in the top of the ninth. A 94-mile-an-hour heater. Floyd records his first punch out in relief, brought to you by Super One Foods. Great quality at super low prices.
It's almost like that was the battle between those two to see who, you know, was going to be that third guy. And I think, although Sammy Dutton pitched pretty good, Grant Taylor was overwhelming for the Florida Gators.
One thing that was impressive about Dutton, and you don't know how much goes into the butterflies, the overexcitement going into your first SEC start on the road against a very potent offensive team, but he really settled down after a couple of free passes to start that game. He was able to get into a groove. But, yeah, I agree with you. I think both options are on the table for Taylor and Dutton, two very good young pitchers for this Tiger team. 0-1 the count. Floyd starts out Holt with a called strike. Here's the 0-1. Misses outside. Evens it up. One ball, one strike.
If you remember the Texas game back at Minute Maid, when Sammy Dutton pitched, I believe it was the Texas game. It might have been Oklahoma, but Jay Johnson actually went out for the first time of the season to pull the pitcher, and it was specifically to congratulate Dutton on such a great outing. So he showed then that he could pitch on the big stage, and like you said, sometimes you got to figure out how to breathe in a big start. It took him a minute to do that, but he recovered nicely.
1-2 on a swing and miss for Holt. Mason Holt, again, a bright spot for the Warhawks tonight. Two home runs, a solo shot in the first, two-run blast in the fourth, struck out last time in the seventh, and now on the ropes here with two outs and a 1-2 count in the top of the ninth inning. Floyd with the delivery, and Holt stays alive, fouls it off behind the plate, still 1-2.
The thing that I like about Dutton, it is max effort every pitch. He's coming at you. He doesn't have any fear of failure, and he's very aggressive. He's a great competitor, so I'd like to see more of him on the weekends.
Re-racket, one ball, two strikes with two outs. Floyd, the delivery, and again, Holt just stays alive, sends one to the railing of the first base dugout of the Tigers. Another Rotolo's foul ball tonight. Tigers 15 runs on 8 hits, as Doug pointed out. They've used the long ball, extra base hits to do the scoring tonight. One error in the field.
6 walks and 5 hit by pitches didn't hurt.
Warhawks 4 runs, 7 hits, and 1 error as well. Top of the ninth, 2 outs, a 1-2 count to Mason Holt at the plate. The pitch, did he go? Yes, he did. That'll do it. Tigers win, Tigers win. Pitch up in the zone from Floyd. He records the strikeout, his second in the top of the ninth inning. The Tigers take the win tonight, 15-4. Move their record to 18-7. They remain 3-3. In SEC play for Louisiana Monroe, they now fall to 8-14-1. They remain 3-2-1 in Sun Belt action. Tigers with the midweek win once again tonight. The final, LSU 15, ULM 4. More coming your way on the LSU Sports Radio Network.